the house. My guest today is awesome. He is a former Navy SEAL who happened to be born in West Africa and then moved to New York City with his mother and brother, following the death of his father. 2002, he joined the U.S. Navy, ultimately completing BUDS, Basic Underwater Demolition / SEAL Training. His name is Remi Adeleke, and let's just say that his SEAL service was the beginning of who this person is. He's worked in Hollywood. He's an accomplished author now. He's working on screenplays. He is awesome. I am super humbled to call this man my friend, and I'm going to shut up. Episode 140 with Remi Adeleke. Enjoy.
Okay, got the red smoke. Gun run, north and south, west of the smoke, west of the smoke.
Okay, copy, west of the smoke. I'm looking at danger close now.
Come on, win it, baby, give it to me, I need it. Get cleared hot.
Copy, cleared hot.
I think the most important place we can start is talking about Ryan Reynolds, because you said you did technical advising for Six Underground. Yeah, he seems to be an awesome dude.
He's a good dude, man. Like, he's a straight-up dude. Like the way he is in films is the way he is in person. Like,
okay, that's what I was hoping. Yeah. I was hoping that he was identical, camera on or camera off. Because people ask me about Joe. That's how Joe is. Yeah, he's exactly the same.
Yeah. No, he's that way. He's cool. He's super respectful. He's down to earth. He, like, literally, I was just like, man, this is a regular dude. And I've gotten that. Like, I work with Mark Wahlberg on Transformers, and he was the same way. And you know, become surprising the more you work with these guys to just see how regular and down to earth they are. You know, family guys, and you know, so.
Yeah, because they get to this place, right, where money, not an issue anymore. Opportunity, not an issue anymore. And it seems like some of them are like, you know what? Fuck everybody else.
Yeah. But here's an interesting thing I found. It hasn't been like the super big stars, like the people who have been like that. It's been, at least from my experience, it's been like the medium, the up and comers who are like, they're just getting their big break and they're like smelling themselves and they're like, oh, I'm about to blow up, and there's that cockiness. Everybody, for the most part, like they've been like, Anthony Hopkins was like cool, man. He was like super cool, down to earth.
You probably met him on the Transformers series.
Yeah.
How did you get into film? I mean, there's so many things we should talk about, but I need to talk about Ryan Reynolds, Anthony Hopkins. We got to talk about movie star shit.
Yeah, you know, I got out in 2016, and
why did you decide to get out?
My dad died when I was 5, so you know, I had 2 kids at that point, 2 sons, and I just felt like I really needed to be around them, because you know how it is in teams, work up, pro dev, you're just gone so much, and you know, having had a father die at 5, I just wanted to be home with my boys. So that's why I got out, and then I thought I was going to go into speaking, you know, public speaking. I was working in ministry too, so I thought I was going to do that. And there was nobody calling, man. Like, it was like nobody, the phone wasn't ringing. I was like, what's going on? And finally, you know, I was in grad school at the time, finishing up my master's. And I was just like, you know what, I'm going to just focus on school and then see what happens. And Charlie, he got killed in Iraq in May of 2016, and I was at his memorial service, and some 2 dudes from the industry were there, 2 team guys who worked in the film TV. I won't mention their names, but they pulled me aside. They was like, man, somebody's been trying to get in contact with you about some project. We haven't been able to track you down. Apparently they have been emailing me at an old email. And it wasn't
the old email,
yeah, address. Old email address. and it was like, hey, you know, give us your email. So I get, and your phone number. So I gave it to him. And then like 2 weeks later, I'm writing papers at my desk, and I get this phone call from this lady who works with Bay. And she's just like, hey, you know, Bay's looking for somebody to help out on Transformers. It's starting tomorrow. What's your schedule like? I can't find anybody. I was just like, well, I'm writing papers. I can be up in LA tomorrow. So.
Were they looking for stuff on the technical advising side of the house?
A combination of technical advising and like background extra type stuff.
I think I know who these 2 guys were.
Yeah. I'm 100% sure you know who these 2 guys were.
I won't mention any names either, but yeah, it's an interesting cast of crew that works in that ecosystem up there.
Yeah. And so I get up there and you know, work with Michael and Michael Bay and
so
Josh.
How was that?
It was like,
how much did he yell directly at you? Because I hear he yells a lot.
Yo, he yelled at me one time. But not that first day. He yelled at me one time. But this was because that one day ended up turning to 3 weeks, and 3 weeks turned into 6 months.
Yeah.
And
multiple movies, right? Project.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And Six Underground was the second movie with Bay I worked on. But he yelled at me when we were in Michigan filming the submarine scene. And he yelled at me one time. I know he felt bad about it, and he never did it again.
Did he legit like try to break it off in your ass?
Yeah, well, the good news was he was really far away from me. Cuz I was on the top of this submarine I'm gonna be careful how I say it. He was kind of wrong in this situation cuz he was telling me to
He was in charge, however, maybe not correct.
Yeah. He was telling me, "Hey dude, like go to the end of the submarine."
No.
And there's a hatch. He wanted me to walk past the hatch. And, you know, obviously it's an open room. You clear it, then you keep moving or you go down it. And I kept going down it, like clearing it and then making my way down as the rest of the action went forward. And he's like, "Why are you going down there? Like, you want to do that?" And I was like, "No, dude, like I want to just walk past the open. I would at least hold on it so the guys could blow by me." And then finally we did the takes and then like the next day we reshot it and he had me go down. And but he was yelling at me the whole time. I'm like, "Dude, go, why the hell are you going?" It's like, it is what it is.
I've heard some legendary tales of him snapping and just going fucking high and right on set.
They call it Bayham, but.
Bayham?
Yeah, they call it Bayham. But all in all, man, he's a great dude to work with. You know, I think what it boils down to is he's all about excellence. He's all about, "Hey, I want things done a certain way," and executing on that way. And you know, and that's where that passion comes from. His passion to execute on a project. And so,
and he might have learned that from, I mean, I don't know his lineage in film, but he might have come up under somebody who got the response they were looking for from that method.
Spielberg. I mean, I don't know. I know he came up under
Spielberg?
Yeah, I think he was like an assistant or intern or something like that for Spielberg for a bit.
Did Spielberg have any good films? I'm trying to think.
I think he did. Saving Private Ryan maybe being one of them.
Yeah, completely reshaped the film industry.
Now, I don't know how, you know, I've never worked with Spielberg, so I don't know how much of Spielberg's persona is like is has been implemented in the Bay, but you know, because look at Spielberg's stuff, is, you know, everything he does is excellent and amazing. You know, so, but also all in all, man, Bay's an awesome dude to work with. He's fun. I mean, he shoots quick. Like he does so many breakdowns and setups in a day. It's just like, dude, the amount of work that he's able to get done in a day is like, it's crazy
in comparison to his peers,
in comparison to other directors. Yeah, he's just shooting super fast. And
I could tell you Michael Bay films. If you were to just play a Michael Bay film straight out, the number of like white phosphorus explosions that occur, I could tell. I was watching Six Underground. And it's just, you see him like arcing across behind the cars. Then you watch Transformers. And if you only just look at the similarity in the explosive, like pyrotechnic stuff, like that's Michael Bay.
Well, and you know why? It's because. Because
he probably personally loves it.
Well, that, but he's a loyal dude. Like, he's a loyal dude.
And what I mean by that, same people.
He hires the same. Once he likes you and he sees that you can get on task with the program, he will hire you for years. So when you look at the end credits for most of his movies, you know, he'll have the same producers, he'll have the same, you know, tech advisors, he'll have the same, you know, just background people who work on set, you know. I mean, he's a super loyal dude, you know, publicist, everything.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So you started in the film industry on little Transformers.
Yeah.
So a documentary series.
Yeah.
Which one were you on? Was your
It was the last one he did, Transformers the Last Night.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then where did your career in film go from there?
You know, after that, I started getting hit up by other people in the industry. So I did two commercials with Peter Berg. There was another team guy. His name's Ray, real good dude. He reached out to me. He's like, "Hey, I heard you work with Bay on this. You want to come work on a project?" So I did two commercials with Pete there, and then I did like some work on SEAL Team CBS, specifically when there was an episode that had to do with race. And so I worked with Neil Brown Jr., who's the Black SEAL on the show, to kind of help, kind of, you know, just massage it to make sure that it wasn't too over the top. And then
because you could easily take that episode way too far.
Oh yeah. And man, it's crazy because you got to be careful what you say, because you know what I mean. But I don't want to say it was over. It just could have been executed a bit better. And then when I say that, I don't mean in the storytelling aspect. I just meant that and how it portrayed the teams. So it was a blessing to, you know, have been a team guy to be able to kind of, you know, correct it, so to speak, and just make it. Authentic while protecting the teams at the same time.
You're in a unique place to be able to do that.
Yeah.
I get hit up, oh my God, the number of times that I am asked about diversity in the SEAL teams.
Yeah.
You know, should you, why aren't there more fill-in-the-blank ethnicities?
Yeah.
Should there be? And I can only talk from my experience.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, I'm glad that you are around to do that because, like I said, you're in a unique place to be able to speak to that.
Yeah.
Because I think it's something like, I didn't watch that episode because I refuse to watch anything that has the word SEAL in front of it. But it would be easy for them to create an episode that was more about the national message and get lost in that as opposed to the realities of what you lived through. Because how long were you team guy for? 10?
8 years, man. So I got through Buds in 2007. And
what class were you?
266.
Okay, so I proctored 264.
You were my proctor for 266, for dive face.
Was I? I thought I proctored 264.
Nah, man, you're the class proctor. You were a proctor for 266. So there's Charlie Keating and all of us were
Ian
in that
Roy
class.
And
Ian Roy. Well, no, Ian Roy was 264.
Okay.
Yeah, and then he got rolled, I want to say, I can't remember if it was SQT or what.
We ended up again serving at Team 3 at the same time. It was weird. Yeah. I did that tour as an instructor, got commissioned, walked across the street.
Yeah.
People don't believe
it. I forgot you got commissioned.
I did. That's proof that the military advancement system is broken. I have no college degree whatsoever, and I went from being an E6 to an O1 overnight with no additional training.
Dude, you didn't have a college degree?
No.
That
still
is
don't.
Crazy, dude.
But so it was the LDO program, the Limited Duty Officer program.
Yeah.
And I got passed over for E7 3 years in a row.
Oh, wow.
When I was on the East Coast and when I got medevaced out, I was doing my LPO tour, and so they marked it incomplete.
Oh, that sucks, dude.
Oh, no shit. Does it?
Yeah.
Tell me something I don't know.
I'll say it again. That sucks, man.
So I'm sitting there, and I put in my chief package, and my record was okay, and I had some deployments, and I had some good military awards. And I'm thinking, I get this shit in the bag.
Yeah.
And the results come out for 7. My name's not on it.
Oh, that sucks, man.
Yeah, so I'm like, you know, of course, going through the list, I'm like, this must not be alphabetical. I'll just look at this list harder. No, it was alphabetical, and they were skipping my name. I'm like, all right, whatever. Second year, same thing. Didn't get picked up. Man. And I knew a guy who was on the board. And they're not supposed to say anything, so he very politely was like, hey, you didn't get an LPO tour, so they just swept your record off the table.
That's stupid, dude.
Yeah. So I was sitting there thinking, okay, I want to be in the military. I was doing some research, and found the LDO program, which is supposed to be for like 7, 8s, and 9s. So I threw in for it for an E6 and then got picked up. And I remember going over to the exchange. I literally, the last day of September in 2008, I was an E6. October 1st, 2008, I was an O1.
Yikes.
And I went to the exchange and I said, hello, ma'am, I need officer uniforms.
Yeah.
And also, I don't know which ones that I need, so can you do everything for me? And those ladies over at NAB dialed me in.
That is awesome, dude.
And then I walked over to Team 3 and ended up deploying with probably 2/3 of the guys that I had put through training. It was a really weird, like, 4 to 6 year time period.
That is crazy, dude. Well, you got the khakis after all, then.
I did, yeah, and I didn't know how to wear them. I remember the first time I put them on, I walked over to the first phase office.
Yeah.
And my buddy Jason, he's out. It's Jason Tushin. He's awesome, dude.
Oh, yeah. He's messaging.
And I was like, hey, man, do I have this on right?
Yeah.
So, proof that the military advancement system was completely broken.
Yeah.
I didn't realize I was your proctor for your Buds class.
Yeah, you were,
for
man.
Second phase.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
If I'd have known that, I'd have failed you.
No, you don't remember the whole tread deal with me, because Instructor Kraft was there. So I had got dropped in dive phase the first time I was in Buds. I don't know if you remember.
Dropped?
Yeah, I got performance dropped.
I did not remember this. Tell this tale. When did you go through first time?
I was in 250.
Okay.
And then 251, and then 253.
Holy cow, what happened on your first journey?
So I showed up to Buds and I had just learned how to swim. Yeah, man.
What the fuck were you thinking?
Dude, I grew up in the Bronx, man.
Like, I'm aware of this.
There's no pools in the Bronx, man.
But if you want to be a SEAL, you need to do the requisite training in the water.
I know. So here was my thinking. I when I showed up to boot camp, I couldn't swim, period.
How did that go? Because there's the swim test.
I barely passed it. I was NQS. I was on the verge of being NQS, and my fear was being part of that group that had to march to the pool every morning, like super early in the morning.
Yep.
And so I just, when I jumped in the pool and I had to do, I just got on my back, Like literally, and I just started doing crazy stuff on my back.
We gotta describe this though too, because in boot camp, I haven't thought about this in 20 some years.
Yeah.
They put you up on that tower.
Yeah.
So it's not, you're not standing, like if this table was the pool, you're not just standing on the edge. What would you say it is, like 10 feet off the ground?
No, it's higher than 10 feet off the ground.
It might be, right? It's enough that I remember people up there not wanting to jump. And I was born and raised around the water, so I'm sitting like, what the fuck is wrong with you?
Yeah, there were people up there crying.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And shaking.
They're shaking, yeah.
Mind you. Yeah. It's a tower over water, and it wasn't like 30 feet.
Yeah, no, it wasn't 30. It was
15.
About I would say 15. At the CTT at Buds, is that what was that? What's the high one? What's the high? Is that because there's two?
Oh, and it's not even that high. Maybe 9 meters. So what would that be? 18 feet? Because I'm trying to think of the one at the CTT. Which we're talking about CTT is combat training tank, which is the pool. There's three, right? It's like low, middle, high.
No, there's two. There's a
springboard one there, right? There's like
No. There's
God
just that.
It,
both of them are hard. Both of them are like, there's that lower one, and then you go up the ramp a little bit higher, and then there's a higher one.
It can't be more than 15 feet.
Yeah. So I would.
Maybe it's a five. And you know, it's probably a 5 meter.
I'm bad with meters, man. I'm bad with math, bro.
carry the one, 15. Yeah. I forgot about that, though. Yeah. You have to do, what were we, did they make you jump in our dungarees?
I think they made you jump in. And then you had to
tread for a little bit.
A little bit of time. And then you had to just swim to the other end.
And people lost their shit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Holy cow. So you did not know how to swim when you were stepping up on the tower.
No. But I was just like, in my mind, I was just like, there were three things. One, I was sick.
Oh,
I was super sick because you know how you get the boot camp crud, everything going around. Two, like, I didn't want to be NQS. Like, I didn't want to be part of that group. And three, like, I was like, man, I want to be a SEAL one day. Like, if I'm going to be a frogman one day, dude, I gotta start here. Because, and back up a little
yes,
bit.
Yes, Remy. Dude. You need to start there. You need to start with your ability to not die with jumping in the water.
Well, here's the funny thing. Like a day or 2 days before, a SEAL came to I mean, he may have been stationary. I can't remember his name. I think he ended up getting killed in a rollover in Arizona.
Okay.
But anyway, he came and he did this presentation for my boot camp division. Now, here's what SEALs do. If you want to take the
probably before the selection screener.
Yeah, if you want to take the selection, let's go. You know, you can go do it. Yeah. And I watched everybody leave, like all the guys who wanted to go leave the class, and I was stuck there, and I felt shamed. I was just like, damn, dude, like I wish I could go do the test with them. And so when I went to go jump, I was like, I don't care, dude, if I drown, like I'm gonna prove that I could be a part of that program. So I just jump in, dude, and I fight my way to the top. And I tried when I started doing the treading, I was just like, I was literally fighting to stay above water.
You were just inventing swimming strokes.
I was making it up. I was swallowing water, dude, and like spitting it out. And then finally, I was just like, when they blew the whistle to swim, I tried to swim on my stomach. It wasn't working. I was just sinking. So I figured, all right, let me get on my back. I get on my back and I just start doing this frog thing, dude. And I was in a hurt locker, dude, because I'm like, I'm putting everything into this. And then finally, I get to the end, and I pass. And I didn't have to be part of that group that showed up every morning. Which, interestingly, the majority of them are African-American. Like, I remember in the mornings, I would just see these long lines, because you had to march there. And
I remember that, because if you're going to the fleet, you have to be able to swim.
You have to be able to swim, man. I did not want to be part of that group. So, anyway.
I had forgotten about that day in my life, but you talking about that swim test, I am so glad you brought that up.
Yeah.
It was one of the first experiences. Again, I was from a beach town in California, right?
Yeah. So you brown water.
Played water polo and grew up doing junior lifeguards.
Yeah.
Used to being around the water. And I remember in boot camp thinking, this is a weird group of people.
Yeah.
There's some people up here who are losing their shit.
Yeah.
What is the rest of the military going to be like for them?
I know.
So how did you pass the screening test? Because now we're talking some underwater recovery stroke, which is the most dog shit swimming stroke ever.
Yeah. So what I did was I got to my first command, which was Naval Hospital Camp Pendleton.
Okay, so you didn't screen in boot camp.
No, I didn't. No,
good call. You would have died on that screener.
I literally would have. And I was skinny, dude. Like a lot of people, they don't realize, man. I grew up skinny. I fought a lot as a kid in the Bronx.
Yeah.
But I was super, super skinny.
I'm going to guess these were non-sanctioned bouts.
No, absolutely not, dude.
Okay, just making sure.
Jumped. Like I did through it all, man.
You're talking about street fight, not inside of the ring.
Slammed on the concrete, like, yeah, just going for broke, getting like.
Was that just part of the deal growing up there, or was that something you sought out, or something you got wrapped into?
It's like, and I don't want to use the term kill or be killed, but it's just one of those situations where, you know, you got to fight back. Like, you're going to get picked. It's like a rough environment to grow up in. And if people see that you're going to take, you know, take nonsense, and they're going to push you on those. They're going to push those buttons. And, you know, and then you're fighting for respect, and you're fighting for, you know, you're fighting. Like, for example, I remember one time I was, this probably help explain it better, but I was about 8, 9 years old, maybe 9 or 10. And I was on a basketball court playing basketball. I'm playing this kid who's had to be like a year younger than me, and I'm crushing him. I'm talking all kinds of junk. Like, I'm like, yeah, man, I'm good. I just shot. You can't beat me. Like, all this. And this is DeVoe Park, which is a crazy park in the Bronx. It's like right where I live. I mean, people got killed, the crackheads, all that. And the kid starts telling me, shut up, man, stop talking, shut up. And I didn't think anything of it, but I just, you know, I'm just continue talking my smack. And so after I beat him, he's like, I told you to shut up. Like, you disrespected me. I told you to shut up. I'm like, yo, man, it's just a game, man. Like, it's not that serious. He's like, no, it's not just a game, man. You disrespected me. So he's like, watch what's going to happen. Say one more thing. I'm like, and again, it's a respect thing. So I'm like, yeah, I'm going to say, what you talking about? Go do whatever you're going to do. Like, I can't remember verbatim what I said, but I challenged what he said. He's like, I bet. And so he leaves the basketball court, and he comes back like 20 minutes later. And I remember, across the street from the basketball court was this bodega, and he's at the light, and he's with two men. And I'm like, why is this kid with two men? And a part of me is like, yo, Remy, leave. Like, go home.
Your early situational awareness was kicking in.
Go home. Like, but a part of me was like,
how old were you in this story?
I was like 9 or 10.
Okay, so this is young Remy.
Young Remy. And I was like, I'm not going nowhere, because this is the environment that I grew up in. I'm not going nowhere. Like, let's see what's going to happen. What they're going to do to me, you know? I need to stand my ground. Like, I need to, I can't be, because if I run away, what's going to happen when they see me 2 days from now walking through the park? So they cross the street. I start sweating. I start getting hot because I know it's about to go down. And they approach me. And it was his uncle, who was like 35, 34. He just got out of prison. And it was his older brother, who was 19. And he pointed to me. And he's like, that's him right there. Like, that's him right there. So they approached me, and they're like, you talking cussing shit to my nephew. My other one's like, my brother. I was like, you know, we're just playing basketball. He's like, it's just bad. I'm a kid, so I'm not thinking they're gonna attack me. He's like, nah, little nigga, this and that, you don't do that. This is just, you don't talk to him like this. And they proceed to beat the shit out of me, dude. Like,
grown men.
And the kid. And I'm like 9, 10 years old.
Damn.
And I couldn't really fight back, because it was like, we knew, like, they had a reputation in the environment that I grew up in, the neighborhood I grew up in. They carried guns, they sold drugs, all that.
Yeah.
So I couldn't really fight back. After they beat the brakes off me, they stand me up, spit on me. They tell a kid, yo, spit on me. They punch me in my face, and then they walk away. And then I go home. And I just tell that story because that's an example. It's just like, why does that happen? It's just, part of it is, it's this false sense of I need to have respect. Because if I don't stand up for myself, I'm going to just keep getting disrespected. It's like a dog-eat-world, whatever that term is. And that's just what it was. That's how a lot of the fights that I had was, you disrespected me. Well, what you going to do? Oh, you going to see what I'm going to do. And I don't know, being a grown man now, I don't agree with it. You know, I don't like it. And this is why we see even now, well, a lot of the crime in inner cities, a lot of the black-on-black crime, when you really look at why it happens, it all comes down to you disrespected me.
So how do you change that environment? Like, if you could go back and switch yourself with 9-year-old you, what would you have changed differently? Because like you said, you still had to live there.
Yeah.
You know, turning tail and running may not have made it better for you in the long run. I mean,
I would have did what my brother did. So my brother was the complete opposite of me. My brother ended up graduating high school in 3 years. He ended up getting a full ride academic scholarship to Syracuse University.
So he's the opposite of you and me, because I'm a retard.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. He's they used to call us Pinky in the Brain growing up. Seriously, you remember that cartoon? They used to call us Pinky in the Brain. Oh, and guess who was Pinky?
Yeah.
But my brother, he had a life changing incident happen when he was about around the same age, or maybe a bit younger, because you know my dad died when I was 5. And my mother struggled financially to provide for us, and she was a teacher in the South Bronx. And so my brother came home one day and he had a bad report card. And I don't know, there were probably some things that happened to my mother in that day. Maybe she couldn't pay the bills. Maybe, I don't know what it was, but it was just a combination of things. And my mother just broke down crying when she saw my brother's report card, because my brother had failed like 3 classes. And he's the oldest. And she was just like, Bio, like, I'm struggling to provide for you and your brother. Like, you can't fail. You can't fail. Like, why did you do this? And she wasn't like berating him. She was like at her wit's end. And she didn't know how to motivate him at this point.
Yeah, she sounds like she's verbalizing her frustration.
Exactly. And a switch went off in his head. And after that, he was in he lived in the library. Like, he lived in the library, or he lived at home in the books, just reading books and doing all of the things that he was doing. And so if I could have gone back and done things differently, I would have did what my brother did. And people didn't really mess with my brother because he was the nerd. He was like, you know, that saying in that movie, The Professional, no women, no children. Like, it's like, no women, no children, no nerds. Like, he's a dude that's going to make it out and do something great.
And so he kind of got a pass because of
that. So he kind of got a pass. And he stayed away from it. And, you know, ended up rising. Now he's an engineer. He has his master's in computer science engineering and a bachelor's in electrical engineering. He's crushing it. He's crushing it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
How did you guys find your way to the Bronx? How'd you guys land there?
So I was born in Africa. My dad, my story really, like, a lot of how I ended up in the Bronx really starts with my dad. My dad, his father, sorry, let me know if I'm going
no,
too far.
No, go, man, go for
information.
It.
But my father, his father had like 9 wives. Because my father was Nigerian, and my father and my grandfather were Nigerian, obviously, and they were part of the Yoruba tribe, and part of that cultural trend was, you know, you could have multiple wives. So my grandfather had 9 wives, and he kept on having daughters. And finally, my dad was born. So my dad was the firstborn son, so along with inheriting the last name, Adeleke, which means the crown is above, he inherited the title of chief. So in European culture and Western culture, we refer to royalties like king, queen, prince, princess, Dutch lord, that sort of thing. In West African culture, especially Nigerian culture, royalty is referred to as chief and your last name. And so my grandfather ended up dying when my father was like 10, and then his mother moved him down to the south of Nigeria. And there were missionaries there that not only taught the Bible, but they taught science and math and literature, a lot of Western topics that we learn in school today. That was taught in school, in Western schools at the time. And so my dad ended up, you know, he was a savant, kind of like my brother. You know, he picked it up fast, and he ended up getting a scholarship to London University. I believe it was London, some school in London, to study architecture and engineering.
Damn.
Yeah. Full ride scholarship.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And so he went to the West and got his bachelor's, got his master's, and then he just started building like all of his wealth. He started building business. He's like one of the first black men on the board of the World Trade Center in New York City. He was the first black man on the board of the Financial Planning Council in Great Britain. I mean, this dude was a beast. He started all kinds of different businesses. He was good friends with the architect of the World Trade Center, the Twin Towers. But after years of accumulating all this wealth, he was just like, I need to go back to my country, because he hated the stereotype that, you know, Africans were a bunch of uneducated bush people who couldn't do anything, and Nigeria being so rich in resources, oil, gold, natural gas, cocoa. Like, he was just like, man, Nigeria could be so much more than what it is. And so he went back and he started a bunch of businesses, car dealerships, consulting firms, engineering firms. And then he started this project called the Lagoon Development Project. And around that time, this is before he met my mother. But around that time, it was like a military takeover. And so he had ended up buying this plot of land called Marico, which was 8 million. He paid 8 million pounds for it. And a few years later, the military government took it from him. It was just like, you can't have this. This is ours now. So he went to court. This is in the 70s. He went to court for like 10 years and fought the government. And finally, the federal government said, okay, we're not going to give you back Marico, but what do you want? And so my dad was like, I want the lagoon. So he asked for this lagoon, which was a swamp at the time, because he was going to hire engineers. He ended up hiring Dutch engineers to dredge the foreshore to develop the Lagoon Development Project, which was an island, one of the first man-made islands in the world. It existed.
Dude, your dad sounds fucking awesome.
He was a beast, man. He was a beast. That dude was brilliant. Like, so many people, when I talked to his peers and people who came up with him, they was just like, fuck, your dad was a visionary. He's so ahead of his time.
Like, he sounds like it in many ways.
In many, many ways. And so he developed this, He developed this, which is now called Banana Island, and people in Nigeria refer to it as Billionaire's Island because billionaires live on the island. A lot of the richest Nigerian, Dangote, lives on that island.
Okay.
And so I say all that to say, around this time is when he met my mother. So my mother's from New York City. She grew up in Harlem and back and forth between Harlem and the Bronx. And I tell people all the time, my mom and my dad's story is the real coming to America story. Because my mom, she went to the Metropolitan Museum of Natural History one day because she loved art. She was a flight attendant. She had a break, so she went there. And my dad, he was into the arts heavily. And he went there, and it was an exhibit on Yoruba, which is the tribe that we're from. And so that's where they met. They got married 5 months later. And after they got married, my mom moved to Nigeria with him. And that's why, in short, that's how we ended up back in the Bronx. So when my dad died, after everything happened, the Nigerian government stripped him of everything, which I can get to that in a second. My mom was just like, there's no way I'm raising my kids here in Africa. I'm taking them back to New York City, that's how I ended up in the Bronx. But
why did they strip him of everything?
So my dad, after he developed the island, the Lagoon Development Project, after he developed Banana Island, the Lagos state government came in and said, you can't have this. The federal government who awarded this to you because of Marico that they took from you, they were never supposed to award. They have no jurisdiction over that, over the foreshore. It belongs to the Lagos state government. At this point, my dad had invested millions of dollars. He already signed contracts with Mark and Spence, which was like a department store in London. He signed contracts with Disney. He signed contracts with McDonald's. I mean, he had invested everything. He already started development on a building development.
To bring all of those things there.
To this island.
Yeah.
And so much so, he would invest so much of his assets and money into it that my mother, being in New York, would say, "Bio, I don't trust the government system." He said, but let's put some money back in the States. Let's put some money in New York City or New Jersey, whatever, just in case something happens, we have something to come back to. And my dad would always say, my priorities right now is Nigeria. Let's get this off the ground. And as soon as it's functioning, we'll be collecting crazy money for the rest of our life and rent and all of these other fees for people being on this island. And so when the Lagos state government came in and said, you can no longer have this, it belongs to us, my dad started going to court and fighting him and saying, no, this belongs to me. And they ended up taking it. And when they took that island, all of his money, so much of his wealth and his assets and his arts and everything was wrapped up in it
that he lost them everything. With it. Yeah.
And he died like fighting them. He died literally weeks later. Like he got bit by, it was like a sequence of events. And that's why I always say it's mysterious. My mom was always just like, it was the government to kill him. But He was stressed out. He left the compound, went for a walk. A dog attacked him, bit him. He got rabies from the dog. We later found out he got rabies. He went to the hospital. They administered him bad medication, the wrong medication to treat the rabies. He ends up dying. And when he died, there was nobody to fight. My half-brother, John, who's a lawyer, he's still on the case. As a matter of fact, the Nigerian government offered him like, I think it was like $8 million. A few years ago, he turned it down because the islands were billions. So
yeah.
The case is still open. So my half brother John was just like, I think he was either in law school or just getting out of it. So he had no juice. Nigeria is a whole nother place. Like, you know what I mean? And John was educated in Britain. So he wasn't about to be this British, he's Nigerian, but this Nigerian British dude coming back to Nigeria telling people how it should be. My dad, he had the relationships, he had the connections, he had the roster to be able to fight them. My half brother didn't. And so, you know, when my dad died, my half-brother told my mother there's nothing left. Like, everything was wrapped. Even this house that we're in right now, with the funeral for my dad was in the house, this is not going to be ours after you leave. And so that's how it all happened. And so
your mom basically grabbed the kids.
It was just like
left
pop smoke.
Everything behind and jammed to landed in Brooklyn.
Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing with nothing. Like, literally no money. Like, people ask me all the time, you know, Remi, where do you get it from? The perseverance, the ability to keep going. And it's my mom, man. When after my father died and my mom came back home after she buried him, she called up her cousin, and he was a lawyer in New York City, kind of well to do. You know, he lived in the suburbs of New York. And she said, listen, my husband's dead. My kids, I don't know how I'm gonna feed them. I don't know how I'm gonna do anything. Can I just borrow some money? so that I could, you know, until I figure things out. I have no money. And he was like, let me call you back in 5 minutes. About 5 minutes later, the phone rings, and it's a woman on the phone, and it's his wife. And she says to my mom, like, how dare you call my husband and ask him for money? Like, who the hell do you think you are? Like, you don't do that. If you want money, you come through me, you go through me. How dare you? And flips out of my head. My mom's husband just died. The kids have nothing. And this woman is now berating her for asking for a loan.
From family.
From a family member. This ain't, you know
what
I mean?
This isn't a cold call.
This isn't, yeah, this ain't a cold call. This isn't somebody off the street. This is a family member. You know what I mean? And my and another part of the story, my grandfather, because this particular cousin, his father was on the, off the deep end. So my grandfather, my mother's father, helped raise him. So that was another reason why my mom was connected to him, because my grandfather helped raise him, you know, because his dad was super abusive. But the blessing in that is, after my mom got hung up on, she was just like, I'm never going to be in this position ever again. I never want to be in a position where I have to ask somebody for anything ever again. And my mother, she was grinding, man. I mean, she worked multiple jobs. She was a teacher in the South Bronx. She would take jobs in museums, art galleries. And part of it was to provide, but another part of it was to, you know, I got this chapter in my book, and I talk about my two parents. And one parent for me was my mother, but then another parent for me was the streets and hip hop. And my mother was recognizing that at an early age. And so my mother would try to combat that by, again, taking jobs in museums to expose us to the arts, to expose us to literature, to expose us to education. She would make my brother and I read the New York Times and books. And this is kind of how I got into writing. And she
because she could see the influence of...
Of the streets.
Of just everything else you were exposed to. Okay.
And she was just trying to counter that because she didn't want us to be a statistic. I think at the time, it was like 20% of kids in the Bronx graduated from high school. Like at the time, if my memory serves me, I have all the statistics in my book because I break it all down. But it was crazy, man. Like, and my mother, you know, her being a teacher in the South Bronx, she saw how bad the education system was. I mean, the education system was bad enough. And I tell people all the time, you know, Nigerian parents are very, very strict. Like, they're very, very, you will be somebody. Like,
hey, what do you want to be? It's
exactly.
Like, listen up, you little son of a bitch.
Dude, all my Nigerian cousins in America, is crazy, man. All my Nigerian cousins in America, I have a half-brother who's a doctor. I got a half-sister who just graduated from the top MBA program in Chicago. Another half-brother who's in med school. My brother's an engineer. I got a cousin who's at MIT right now, triple major in biology, computer science, and math. You know, I got another cousin who's a petroleum engineer. I got another. So it's like Nigerian parents, they're all about, and I had a whole bunch of Nigerian friends who their parents were like, you will be a doctor, you will be a lawyer, you will be something in life. And my mother was, she wasn't Nigerian, but she kind of, a lot of that Nigerian culture was imprinted on her because she saw the potential of us because of our father. She saw the potential of us within us, and she was just like, you will be somebody. And so that's why she would fight against, excuse me for that.
Yep, that's right.
She would fight against the trend and try to expose us to the arts and education and homeschool us on top of sending us to school so that we would not end up a statistic. Now, I ended up still going down the wrong path for a bit, but yeah.
As we all do.
Yeah.
But looking back though, do you think it was, you know, the difference between you ending up as a long-term statistic in your life and mm-hmm. what you've been able to accomplish now is a lot of that driven or that fire burned from your mom?
Oh, 100%. 100%. 100%. Because
I don't think you can, I don't think it's possible to accurately state the impact that can have mm-hmm. on the lives of young men and women.
Yeah.
That power of having somebody like
who believes in them.
Who believes in them and also is like, hey, you're going to do this.
Yeah.
You're, not only can you, but hey, asshole, put the Xbox down. You're going to.
And dude, my mother would beat the brakes off me, man. Like, not in an abusive way.
I don't know if that's legal anymore.
I know. My mom's on social media, and she's probably going to get hit up. People are going to start canceling her. Like, you beat your kid back in the 80s.
I don't know anybody, so I'm 42. You've got to be in your late 30s.
I'm 37.
I don't know anybody who is near our age group that didn't get a little bit of a whooping from time to time.
I know. All right.
Like, and I don't know anybody who didn't.
Me neither. Well, I knew one kid I grew up with, but he's crazy now because he didn't.
I was going to say, how'd that guy turn out?
He's crazy now. He's crazy. But, you know, my mother, I wouldn't be who I am without my mother.
Wouldn't be who I am without my parents either. Yeah. I mean, I look back, what you have just described is unbelievable. I'm thinking about your mom, too, of going from a place like
riches.
That's what I was going to say. Like, that probably wouldn't. Was in a place where she didn't need or want for anything because they had the means or the resources to get it, and then go into a place where it's the exact opposite.
We had nannies, we had cooks. I got all kinds of pictures. We had horses. Me and my brother would ride horses with our driver. We traveled all over. We weren't just relegated to Nigeria. We got Paris, France, New York, London. Like, we traveled all over the world. Like, my father would host these lavish parties with expatriates and politicians. I remember I found when I was like about 11 years old, I opened up this file cabinet and I found like a letter from Ronald Reagan, from the White House. Yeah, addressed to my dad. So he, like, we lived a life, like, it was out of a movie. You know what I mean? The life that we lived.
And then to have that.
And to go from that to
gone.
Zero. And my mom, and I tell people all the time, my mother, you know, she was and she still is a very attractive woman. So she could have easily said, you know what, I'm going to just go find a wealthy man to take care of me and my kids. My mother, like, she never remarried. She's never dated. And she tells me, she says, you know, Bio Remi, one of the reasons why I didn't date and I never got married is because I didn't want to bring any confusion into the house. I didn't want to bring anything into the house that would potentially drive you guys in the opposite direction of the direction I was trying to take you in. And I'm not advocating that in any way, but that's how dedicated we talk about.
That's an incredibly rare mentality
and discipline.
Yeah,
that's was her whole life was these two boys will be successful, like no ifs, ands, or buts, and anything that could come in and conflict with that. I'm not chancing it.
She sounds amazing, man.
Yeah, she's on Instagram and she's a fitness, crazy fitness fanatic.
I was looking at your Instagram the other day. Was she the one on the rower?
Yeah, she's on the rower, man. She's on the rower. She was doing push-ups because she come. My wife, she did like a little vacation last week, so my mother flew in to help me out from the Bronx. And
does she still live in the Bronx?
She still lives in the Bronx.
Good for her, man.
She doesn't want. Well, she's starting to look for houses in Eastlake now. Because she's like, I want to be next to my grandkids.
Which so. I would say is the Bronx of San Diego, but it's not.
Yeah, it's not.
I would just try to make. Yeah. So yeah. There's just no comparison whatsoever.
No, 100%, 100%.
Yeah, I lived in Eastlake for at least 6 years.
I love it, man.
It's great.
Because it's night and day for me. It's just like I wake up in the morning, I hear birds chirping. I don't hear like the ambulance driving by and all that. And it's just, it's serene for me at times. I'm just like, man, like, how do I add this life now, you know?
So when did the military start chipping away at your head? When did you even start thinking about that?
Well, it's twofold. It was a twofold process. Like, one, I said earlier, my mom would always expose me to the arts.
Yeah.
And
which traditionally the military is not known for the arts.
Yeah, the art is not. But I'm gonna connect the dots though. How that happened? not at all.
I'm not aware of a military rate that has anything to do with. Well, I guess.
Oh no, the
photographers.
Singers. There's the singers. I saw.
Okay,
a video.
I'm gonna give you that. There's the bands.
That's
there's
art.
Okay.
Yeah, the band and singers.
And the photographers.
That is art.
All right.
Yeah. No, my mother viewed film as the arts. So to her,
I'll give her that too. I agree.
Theater was the arts, film were the arts, and she would like scrounge her pennies and take us to go see like plays, or sometimes she would get us into free plays, and she made it a habit to take us to a movie, try to take us to a movie like once a month, and so it was a film that kind of inspired me. One of the first films inspired me was Bad Boys, because that was the first time I saw two African-Americans who...
I was going to say, we're talking Will Smith,
Marty Ma, Martin
Just
Lawrence.
Wanted to make sure we're talking about the same thing. I watched the shit out of that movie when I was younger.
I know, dude. Dude, I had it on... I remember after it came out, after I saw it, I bought the bootleg. Michael Bay wouldn't appreciate this. But I bought the...
That movie too?
Yeah, he made that movie. Which is a whole crazy cycle into how I ended up...
That's a cool...
How I got into
later
my
on
career.
Connecting like, the dots. Yeah. I just remember him flipping, I think it was a Ferrari, and he's just shooting out of it. I was like, that's living life.
That was Bad Boys 2.
Damn it.
Yeah,
well, it was still Bad Boys.
Yeah, still Bad Boys. See, I'm a real Bad Boys dude.
Yeah, you
joke.
Are.
But that was the first time I saw two guys who felt like I connect with them, and they were playing heroes. So that was the first time I was just like, man, like, there's more out there than just being a drug dealer or being, you know, being a athlete, you know, and or being these other, like, I could be a hero of some sort.
That is crazy that that movie flipped that switch for you.
It did. And then a year later, The Rock came out. And I never knew nothing about Navy SEALs. Like, I never heard of a Navy SEAL.
And you still don't after watching The Rock. Let's be very clear.
Yeah, because they all get killed. But that was the first time I saw Navy SEALs.
You saw handlebar mustaches and MP5s coming out of the sewer grates.
I don't know what kind of SDVs they were, but they weren't real SDVs.
Oh, my God, that's right. They were on some, they pushed it out of the back of some shitty helicopter.
Yeah. They had the SDVs, and they all get smoked. But that was the first time I was like,
yes, they do.
But the suits got me, the black rubber suits and the cameras, all the stuff that's not
They
real.
Look cool as shit.
Yeah, they did.
The night vision goggles that... Yeah, I love the colored thermal, all that
oh,
shit.
Oh, yeah, all of it. The new guy who's like, this is my first op, and he's like, I got to go up there and save my, and he ends up getting smoked. Yeah. So, it was something about that where I was just like, man, these dudes are cool, like, they're in the water, and they were, I was like, man, Navy SEALs. So that's when I started, like, doing my research, and I was just like, oh, these guys are special forces. And in my mind, I said to myself, because I was 15 at the time, I said, if I ever turn my life around, because I was in the streets, I was selling drugs and all this. It's like, if I ever turn my life around, that's what I'm going to do. Like, but then I filed that away, and I'm back in the streets. And, you know, I was selling drugs, mainly in upstate New York. I buy my drugs in Washington Heights, New York City, and go up upstate New York.
What kind of stuff were you trafficking in?
Bad stuff. You know, it's funny, I was on a podcast with Bedros.
Okay.
And he asked me the same question, and I didn't answer. And one of the reasons why I still don't answer fully is because of my mother.
Fair enough.
You know, my mother's always, she's always had a hard time with me sharing this part of my life.
I was just curious if you're selling weed or you went deeper into the matrix.
I was deep
in the matrix. Fair enough.
I was selling some things. And let's just keep it there, just for the sake of my mother. She hates when I even bring it up.
It's part of who it makes you who you are.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I think because of who you are, there's a lot of people who can learn lessons from that.
100%.
Because you never know. People might be in that situation, hear you talking about it, and go, you know what? If that guy can get out of the situation, so can I.
And that's why I try to tell my story. And that's the main reason why I wrote the book, too. You know, sorry to jump off topic. I know a lot of people, you know, in the teams, they frown upon that. But, you know,
writing a book?
Yeah.
I saw the best meme ever the other day. Have you ever seen, like, the vet holding up the sign?
Yeah.
It says, wearing gaiters doesn't make you a Navy SEAL, but writing a book does.
I know, dude. I haven't seen that one. Send it to you. But here's the deal. Like,
the guy holding the sign's wearing gaiters, by the way.
Oh, is he? Yeah. Oh, so he's definitely a team guy.
For sure.
but I struggle with it because of that. But I knew in my heart, I wasn't writing a book. Like, there's only three chapters in the book about the teams. It's a 29-chapter book. I knew I was writing it for that person, for that kid, you know.
And that chapter of your life, the team guy portion of it, it's critical too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I actually get hit up quite often to write a book, and I can't do it because I don't have a story like yours.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, most of my adult life was in the SEAL teams. Mm-hmm. And my theory is there's already enough SEAL books.
Yeah.
I don't need to put, like,
another spin on it.
Yeah. Andy's take.
Yeah.
So no shit.
Yeah, yeah,
there
yeah.
I was. You guys will never guess. I was in the desert.
Yeah. Kicking down doors. Wrapping up the back. Yeah.
Yeah.
And
it's already been done.
Yeah. And that's why I tried to... My whole book is about, I mean, Africa, Bronx, all that, all the way through. But I got into the drug game, and I was making money. But I started to realize.
Is that why you got into it? Just for the monetary aspect?
Money, man, money. Like,
I get the desire or, you know, the want or need to do that if it's an economic solution.
Yeah, I didn't want to be bummy, you know. I wanted to have nice shoes. I wanted to have respect. And again, a lot of it comes back to. And I think, sorry for backtrack, but I think affirmation for me, you know. I feel like it's important for a father to be in their child's life because every child needs their parent to affirm them, especially a father for a son. They need that affirmation. And if you don't receive that affirmation, you're going to start seeking affirmation from peers, other things. And we even see with athletes sometimes, you know, where they go to the club and they're throwing money or they buying all these cars. Like, in my opinion, a lot of that comes back to, you know, affirmation. Like, we're all searching for that affirmation. And I wanted to make money, because not just so that I could have what I wanted to have, but deep down inside, the little kid in me wanted my dad to affirm me. And I wanted people to affirm me. So, like, you're good. You're the man. And so after I was in it, it became too risky for me. Like, that mindset, that my dad's intellect of this is becoming a risk, seeing something that can happen before it happened, that was rooted in me. I began to see what was like two steps ahead of me. And so I was just like, I need to do something else.
It certainly sounds like a risky long-term endeavor.
Oh, no, 100%.
If you extend the timeline on that one, it seems to always lead to the same place, incarceration or death.
In prison.
Yeah.
And so what I started doing was I got into the cell phone scam thing, which wasn't any better because it was a white collar crime.
Do tell. I'm not familiar with cell phone scams.
Yeah, man, I was doing blow up phones, man.
What the hell is a blow up phone?
So a blow up phone. Well, I was just epilogue. I was making tens of thousands of dollars a week. Let's go back to the prologue. I'm a storyteller. So I got this job at this company called MCI WorldCom, which is no longer around. And because I tried to start going, I was still selling drugs at the same time, but I was doing this because I was trying to figure out a way to have that legal balance. And, you know, I was selling phones, but I wasn't making a lot of money. And one of the employees there, he put me onto this cell phone scam thing. Because he was not only was he making tons of money at the company, like legally, but he was making way more money illegally. And he was like always salesman of the quarter, salesman of the month, and yeah, all this. And so what he was doing was he was getting people's PPI, personal information, social security card, date of birth, address, full name. And on if a person had good credit, not excellent credit, but good credit, you could activate three cell phones on that person's credit.
I feel like they didn't realize those cell phones were being activated.
No, they did not.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
That's why I was.
I was gonna say this guy's bad, but this guy's numbers were probably good because
he's selling like,
yeah,
like impossible level numbers of phones in a month, like numbers of phones that no one person should be able to sell. And so he's doing it illegally, but legally he's making a commission off of it. So this dude is pushing a Mercedes Benz. I mean, this dude is like, I went to his house. He's living in like a fat house. And I'm just like, yo, man. So he saw me struggling. So he took me under the wing and he showed me the ropes. And I got into that. So I would activate, you know, three cell phones on one person's line of credit. And then I was selling to drug dealers. And I was selling to everyday people. And the drug dealers liked them because the phone would stay on for 90 days. Because the phone would activate. You get 30 days of use. You get your bill. You got 30 days to pay it. And if you didn't pay your bill, you got 30 days before they shut it off. So I was the first dude that did unlimited services. Because you got to remember, at the time, it was 29. This is 2000, 2001, when cell phones are like just becoming the thing.
You're paying good money for like the 100-minute-a-month plan.
$29.99, 30 minutes. You go over, this was, yeah. I mean, in New York City.
Yeah.
But you go over 30 minutes, you're paying like a quarter, like something stupid.
It
like
was
ridiculous.
Ungodly
yeah.
high.
Stupid.
Yeah.
And so I was doing unlimited plans for 90 days.
The Remi Adeleke unlimited 90-day plan.
Unlimited 90-day plan. Unlimited. And text messages.
Of
unlimited.
Course.
And I'm selling them for like, depending on the phone, because if it was like a you know, StarTech, you know, nice, like the Tic Tac phone, that would go for $700, $800. If it was just a Motorola flip phone, that would go for $300. If it was like a cheaper version phone, $200. And then the pages came out, the time port two-way pages. People were loving that. I was selling those for $500, $600. And then after a while, I was just realizing, you know, I need to get a better source of PPI or I'm gonna get caught up. And so I had a dude who I went to high school with, he was a hustler, and his girlfriend worked at a hospice clinic. And so I connected with him. I was like, yo, man, I need PPI. He's like, people dying all the time. They ain't worried about their credit because these people on the verge of death. And so he would get me sheets of PPI. And on one page was like 10 people's information.
Oh, wow.
And sky was the limit, man. Sky was the limit. And then I was heavily influenced by hip hop and loved rap. I rapped as a kid. And my dream was to be a music mogul. And so I wasn't just making the money to spend it. I was investing in a record company. I actually started a record company, Eighth Wonder Entertainment. As a matter of fact, my production company now is the same name as my record company when I was in the teens doing the stuff. And we did a compilation album. I had artists. We would travel and do shows, and all that money that I was getting from that.
How old were you doing this?
I was 18, 19, 20.
Holy shit.
Making crazy money.
It
crazy
sounds like money. It, yeah.
I had a brand new Lincoln. I mean, it was crazy. I was wild. I was out of control. And you know, there's a saying, you know, wealth from get rich quick schemes quickly disappears. Wealth from hard work grows over time. And you know, when you make a deal with the devil, at some point the devil's gonna come knocking on your door.
It's gonna come full circle
back
at some point.
And that's what happened. People were starting to get caught up at the clinic I was working at. Not the clinic, at the office. People were getting caught and going to federal prison. Getting charged with white collar crimes.
Yeah.
Probably
some substantial white collar crimes.
Oh yeah, because we're talking a lot of money and
personal
information, right? And people were starting to get charged and discovered. And I think the reason why I was away from it was because I was using dead people's information. There was nobody coming in complaining, hey, my credit is messed up, what happened? So long story short, I sell this drug dealer like 15, 20 phones. They're supposed to last for 90 days, Jamaican cat. And I had been selling him phones, but like one, two at a time. And when he came to me and said, hey, I want like 15, 20 phones, a part of me was like, I don't want to do 15, 20 phones. Let's just stick with the one, the two here and there. But he talked me into it. And I knew why he wanted 15 to 20 phones, because he wanted to flip them. So what he was doing was...
Oh, he was going to sell them himself.
He was going to sell them and then double the price, or maybe not double the price, but add an extra 100, 200 on them. And I did the deal, and he did whatever he did with the phones, and it went from 90 days, the phones cut off in like 15 days, 20 days, like super, super fast. And when he hit me up and said that, I'm sweating. I wasn't sweating because I was nervous about him. I was sweating because I was nervous about what was going on.
What happened to the system you had been using?
Yeah, did I get caught up?
Yeah.
And I was just like, man, I'm going to federal prison. Because the dude who taught me to get, the first thing he said to me was, this is the first thing he said to me after he taught me. He said, Fed time. And I said, what?
Wow, he was that upfront with it?
Yeah, he was like, Fed time. If you get caught, this is a federal crime. You are going to federal prison. Fed time. And so those words flash across my mind when the phone was cut off. And I was like, damn, I'm going to prison. It's a wrap. It's over. My life is over. But then I had to deal with this drug dealer. And the way I found out was he came to my house.
He came to my house.
And I was stupid because he lived in the projects off of Bailey Ave in the Bronx. And not Bailey Ave, Gun Hill Road in the Bronx. That's the name of the road, Gun Hill Road. He lived in these projects off of Gun Hill Road. And and every time we would meet, he would never bring me into the projects. He would always meet me outside the projects in my car. Anytime we met in my area, I would bring this dude to my house. I thought about that. Like, I was like, how stupid was I? So anyway, he comes to my house, knocks on my door. I answer it, surprised that he's there. And he's just like, listen, this is what happened. I want my money back. Well, things ain't gonna go too well for you. And I knew him. I knew his reputation. And I was just like, man, this dude's gonna kill me. And my mom is asleep, like two rooms down. This is the living room, my bedroom, then her room. So at this point, I'm like, man, not only did I put my life in danger, but I put my mother's life in danger. And this is all getting to how I ended up in the military. And so, I know I'm giving a long version of it.
It's fascinating, man. Keep going.
And so, he's like, have my money. And I already had money from doing what I was doing. I just had to make an extra couple hundred dollars. So I went out into the streets. I made him his money, like within a day, paid him his money. And then at that point, that was my wake-up call. I was just like, I'm out. Like, I don't know what I'm gonna do with the rest of my life. I'm gonna try my hand at this record company thing for a few months. And if it doesn't work, I gotta figure something else out. So I stopped, I wrote a resignation letter for the MCI WorldCom. And I remember I went into the office. Oh, it was the building was right on 42nd Street, Grand Central Station. It was where the building was. And I remember going into that building that day after everything went down, and I was just like, okay, is this a cop? Is this a cop? Is this a cop? Like, is this undercover? Is this a fed?
So you're slightly paranoid.
I'm paranoid. And in my mind, again, thinking like my father would always think, I don't know how stupid I was, but I was like, maybe if I go in and turn in my resignation letter and quit before all of this blows up on me,
I'll be safe.
Like, this is what I'm thinking, like, in my young, stupid mind. And so I go there, I meet with the manager. I think her name was Mrs. Green or whatever. And I turn in my resignation. I'm like, listen, it's getting too crazy around here with all these people doing all this stealing phones.
These criminals out here selling these lines.
Savages. I was like, I don't want to get caught up in this. I'm trying to turn my life around. So, you know, here, I'm going to get out of here and try and find a job somewhere else. And I remember she was tearing up. She's like, Remi, you've been such a great salesperson. Like, you've been so good on all of these, winning these awards and this and that. She was just like, don't leave. I was like, listen, I got to leave. She was like, okay, I understand. I turned my resignation letter. I'm like, and I was thinking, maybe she's in on it. Maybe she's got a Y on or something. Because she's crying. Maybe she's acting.
She's got a Y on.
But I got out that building, and I never looked back. And
did you ever find out why they were shut off 15 days in?
No, I didn't stick around to find out. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe it was like a random test, maybe to see who was who. I didn't stick around to find out.
Probably the smarter call.
But I get to my warrants later because I had warrants. And when I but when I found out I had warrants, that's when I was like, this is what the warrants are for. Yeah. But I'll get to that. So anyway, like, I do that, and then I had about $10,000 to try my hand at this record company thing and try and invest with my artists, because, you know, in order to make it, you had to make demos, you had to print copies of the CDs, you had to get out there. It costs a lot of money. And so my goal at that point was to try and get a label deal. So I had a meeting with Def Jam Records, which was like the biggest record company, hip-hop record company at the time. And at that meeting, what's the dude's name? His name, Kevin Lyles. So Kevin Lyles, if you're listening, I'm shouting you out because you remember me, we met. You shut down my record company hopes. I go into the meeting, and Kevin Lyles, we played an album for him, the compilation album, we did a compilation album because it had all our artists on it, and each artist had at least two or three songs. And we did that, so just in case he's like, well, I don't like that artist, but I'll take those two artists. He listened to it, and then after he listened to it, he was like, that's cool, but you want to hear, you appreciate this next note. He's like, you want to hear somebody who I just signed, who I think is better than you guys. And at the point, I'm like, dude, if you're telling me that, that means you're not going to sign me to a deal. And the last thing I want to do is hear somebody else.
Hear your shit.
Yeah, exactly. And he plays it, and he's like, this is a dude named Joe Buttons.
Joe Buttons.
I say you probably appreciate it because he's a massive podcaster now.
Oh, is he?
Yeah. Yeah, he has a big podcast. He's not a rap anymore, but he's a super successful podcaster. So I figured you probably knew his name. But anyway, and I was just... I end up not getting a deal, obviously. And that's when I was like, all right, the hustle game's done, music game's done, what I'm gonna do? 3 months go by, I'm sitting in my mother's apartment, and that's when I just feel this presence. I feel something say, you need to get out of here. You need to get out of here. Remember that dream being the SEAL? Like, you need to get out of here and join the military and try and go do that. And I was like, And a big part of me didn't want to join the military because I hated the police. You know, I had some bad encounters with the police growing up in the Bronx. I saw a lot of things growing up in the Bronx as it related to the police and minority community at the time. And a part of me was just like, you know, I associated anybody in a uniform as the police.
As an authority figure?
As an authority figure. And I hated authority. And the last thing I wanted to do was be the police, so to speak. And so when that idea kind of came to me, I battled. But then, in the midst of the battle, I looked around my room and I was just like, what has my life amounted to? Like, what else am I gonna do? Like, what else do I have? Like, I'm not going to college. Like, I can't get into college. Like, I'm not going back in the streets. Why not? You said you wanted to be a SEAL before. Let's see if you can go do that. So I got out, I left my apartment. And I went to Fordham, I ran down Fordham Road, which is a street I grew up on. And I went into the recruiter's office. First, I went into the Marine recruiter's office. Because in my mind, like, I don't know how I associated Navy SEALs with Marines and all. I just went into the Marine recruiter's office.
Because it was those damn Marines in Alcatraz.
Yeah. They smoked us. So I went into the Marine recruiter's office first. I'm like, oh, okay, maybe through the SEALs I could be a Marine. Through the Marines I could be a SEAL because they got guns and all that, you know. And there was this poster of this Marine, he had on like a ghillie suit and a suppressor on his sniper rifle and all. I was like, oh man, this is the SEAL. This is it. Like,
I'm home.
Yeah, I'm going to be that. That's going to be me. And the crazy thing about the story is there was coffee on the desk, but there was nobody in the office. So I sat in the office. The door was open. I sat in the office for like 15 minutes.
Huh.
And nobody showed. There was evidence because it was open, obviously. Yeah. And there was evidence that somebody was in there, but they, I don't know, but they were taking a dump or what, but they weren't in there. So I got up and I walked out and I passed the Army recruiter's office. I peeked in. I said, hey, you know where the Marine dude is? And it's like, nah, we don't know where he is. And I looked, I was like, nah, I'm not going to go to Army. The Army doesn't have SEALs. Yeah, don't do that. So then I walked next door down, Navy SEALs. Okay, Navy. Okay, this is where it's at. All right. This is another avenue into becoming a SEAL, right? So when I walk into the office, another big part of the story is this gorgeous Puerto Rican recruiter in there. Her name is Tiana Reyes. Gorgeous. And I look at her and I was like, man, I'm only gonna get in SEAL teams, but this is gonna be my girl. Like, I'm gonna pull my hip hop, like, yo, what's up, shorty type thing. And and she saw me coming a mile away because she was from the Bronx. She was from the Bronx, and she joined the Navy, and then she came back to the Bronx to be a Navy recruiter. So she
played
the,
you like a
she
fiddle.
She played me like a fiddle. And she was like, so what do you want to do in the Navy? And I left up my arms like, yeah, I'm gonna be a SEAL. Like I had no muscles. I had two tennis balls, like a tennis ball in each arm. And she's like, oh yeah, really? I was like, yeah. She's like, okay, go to the computer and do an ASVAB test because you gotta do a practice test to see if you can get in the Navy. I go and I do the test, and I passed it to get in the Navy, but she's like, you score nowhere near, because you know you got to score high in the ASVAB to be a SEAL. She's like, you score nowhere near where you need to be a SEAL. I was like, dang, so I can't be a SEAL? She was like, right now, nope, you can't be a SEAL, but maybe later. So I was like, all right. So then the next thing she does is she runs my background, and she does a quick search, and she discovers I got two warrants out for my arrest. I'm like, warrants?
And that was news to you at
that point? That was news to me. That was news to me. And keep in mind, I left. This is June of 2002 when I'm in the recruiter's office. I left WorldCom and all that December of 2001, so 4 months after 9/11, right? So I'm like, oh man, like the feds have been looking for me. This is all of the things that's going through my mind because of what happened. The 15 phones are cut off. This, they finally figured it out and they were charging me. They just couldn't find me. So I'm sweating, I'm hot. I get up, I get ready to run. I run towards the exit. And she's like, where are you going? I was like, I'm getting out of here. She's like, I'm not trying to go to jail. I was like, I'm not trying to go to jail right now. And she says, stop. She's like, don't run, because running's not going to get you nowhere. She said, do you have a suit? I said, no, I don't got no suit. Why? I'm trying to get out of here. She's like, do you have a collar shirt and some nice pants? I was like, yeah, I can get some nice pants, but why? Like, I gotta go. You gonna call the cops on me? Like, what are you doing? And she said, no, I'm not gonna call the cops on you. She said, come back tomorrow. I said, for what? She said, just come back tomorrow. She had that snappy Bronx attitude. Just come back tomorrow, okay? So I came back the next day. She was in her dress uniform, head to toe dress uniform. I had a warrant in New Jersey and I had a warrant in New York. And she took me to the judge in New Jersey, drove me in a government car to New Jersey. Got us in front of the judge. I don't know how she did it, but she got me in front of the judge, maybe because she was in her uniform, and she advocated on my behalf. She was just like, listen, this kid's made mistakes, but he's got potential. Like, can we expunge his record? Like, I want him to join the military. He's trying to join the military after an act of war, 9/11 taking place. Is there anything you could do for his record? And the judge was like, if this guy's serious, I will expunge his record.
No shit.
Yep, expunge my record. So the judge in New Jersey expunges my record. The judge in New York, then she drives me to New York. Same thing. The case, I can't remember what the charge was in Jersey. It was a misdemeanor or something. The charge in New York was I ended up getting falsely arrested at a McDonald's in Times Square. for disobeying the lawful order. It's a whole, I shared a whole story in the book, but it was just, it was a bad situation, man. And I remember she was like, I thought you had money with your hip hop stuff. Why are you getting arrested for stealing a cheeseburger at McDonald's? Like, I didn't steal a cheeseburger at McDonald's. I was black at McDonald's. That's what happened. But it was a bad situation. What, you know, what happened in that story was, me and my boys, we were in Times Square doing our rap battle stuff. It was a big thing in front of Virgin Megastore back in the day. All like a bunch of rappers would meet in front of the Virgin Megastore and have these rap battles, like competitions. And, you know, and the hopes was to get discovered because executives were blah, blah, blah. You know, so we did that. And we crossed the street to the McDonald's, which was right across the street from it. And it was packed, tourists, everything, because it's in Times Square, packed.
Which is a shit show for people who haven't been. Well, yeah. Probably not in the last few months, but historically, it's a shit show.
Been there a few times. Crazy. And order my food. Me and my boys, we order our food. And then after we order our food, I was like, hey, because I ordered first, I'm going to go try and find some seats. So we look downstairs, no seats. Walk upstairs, no seats. There's people standing up and eating. And there's just nowhere to sit and eat. And it was cold. This was the wintertime. And it was just like, we were like, we're not going to eat outside. So when we got our food, we stood up and we, just like some of the other people, we stood up and we ate our food. And the security guard was just like, what are you guys doing here? It's like, we're eating. We just ordered this food. It's like, you can't stand up and eat here. It's like, all these tourists over here standing up and eating. We spent money here. Like, what are you talking about? End up getting into an argument. Cops get called. You know, cops are like, you got to leave. You can't eat here. And it just turned into a bad situation. I ended up going to jail and spending the night in jail, got charged, didn't know anything about the court system, and I didn't know I was supposed to go to court.
Yeah.
And that's what my second one was.
The paperwork followed you.
Yeah, yeah. And so that's what the charge was for. Ended up, she ended up doing the same thing, standing before the judge. And the crazy thing about it was the court building was not too far from the Twin Towers. Like, literally, it was like blocks away from where the Twin Towers were. And advocate on my behalf, listen, this guy's made mistakes. He's trying to turn his life around. What happened, you know, shouldn't have happened at the McDonald's, blah, 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 blah. Judge was like, if this dude's serious about joining the military, turn his life around, we'll expunge my record.
Wow.
So then after my record was expunged, she went a step further because you got to fill out that, I don't know if you remember that paper, the legal paperwork you got to fill out to join the Navy, and they ask you all these questions. Check yes if you ever.
Oh, yeah. And the goal is to not check yes.
Yes, yeah. And she was like, check no, check no for everything, because if you check yes, blah, blah, blah. And she was like, I got your record. She'd be completely expunged out of the system so that when we go to MEPS, she timed it. So by the time we got the MEPS, it was out of the system. And you know, she fudged the paperwork, and that's how I got in the Navy. Like, that's literally how I got in the Navy. And she died two years later.
What?
Yeah,
how'd she die?
She had autoimmune disease.
Are you serious?
Man. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, she died. She had a rare autoimmune disease. It was called myositis something. You could look at, like, they have a John Hopkins Institute has a page where you could donate to her specific
deal,
but they still don't have a cure for it. And yeah, when I found that out, man, it crushed me, dude.
Oh, I bet.
Because it was like, man, like, dude, if it wasn't for her, bro, like,
she went above and beyond.
Yeah, she changed the trajectory of my life, and that's where, like, I learned, man, like, from her, man, you gotta be willing to give people second chances, especially people who don't deserve it. One, and two, you gotta be willing to give yourself a second chance, third chance, fourth chance, fifth chance. Because, man, like, what she did, and me and her daughter are real cool right now. Like, me and her daughter's become like my daughter. Her daughter Sierra, shout out to Sierra. We're super cool. Like the best I could do for Tiana is, because her father, Sierra's daughter, father's not in her life, is to try and be in her life. So. And it was my recruiter who really pushed me. Like, and when I say push me, I mean, she really, not pushed me, but inspired me to do the right thing in the Navy. Because I went from this hard environment growing up in the Bronx to the Navy, where I had people yelling at me and you know, so all that, yo, you disrespected me, I'm gonna knock you out, that wasn't gonna fly.
Yeah.
And there were times when.
Yeah, that's not the place to go in with that.
It's not the place to go in, nah. You're gonna get crushed and then end up in the brig. And so, every time I was on the verge of lashing out or, you know, bulking up, I thought about Tiana. Because Tiana told me, Remy, like, the reason why The reason why the military doesn't want you is because they worried about the, your past, your criminal past, criminal activity, you carrying that out in the military.
Yeah.
So you need to be a waymaker, and and what I mean by that is you need to change the narrative so that, because if you screw up, then yeah, I'm possibly gonna get in trouble, but then you're gonna close the door for other people. But if you're successful and you can show like Navy, military, Army, Marines, whatever, that, you know, people can be a success in the military, that can open doors for other people. So do the right thing. So anytime I was on the verge of, and I did do some stupid stuff.
As we all did.
Yeah, I did a lot of stupid stuff.
We all did.
But when it came to doing something, I was strategic, though. I was smart about it. When it came to something that would have openly crushed me, I didn't do it. I held my tongue. And there was so many times where, you know, I was put in a position by leadership where, you know, they're cursing at me, screaming at me, yelling at me, you know, screwing me on my evals and all of the stuff. And I just held my tongue.
So your first duty station, did you go the corpsman route?
Yeah, I was a corpsman.
Pecker, checker.
Yeah, man, yeah.
So you go boot camp, mm-hmm. realize you probably should have learned how to swim. Good one.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah.
So we're learning our lesson. Then I'm assuming you learned how to swim, went to your first duty station, took the SEAL screener.
Not right away. As soon as I got to my first duty station, I watched the Buzz 234 video.
Who didn't? Documentary on Discovery.
The documentary on Discovery Channel.
Which is not an accurate portrayal of Buds.
No, they cut out a lot of stuff.
Yes, they did.
They cut out a lot of stuff.
Let's just say there was the training that occurred with the camera crew there, yep. and the training that occurred when it wasn't.
Were you in that class?
Fuck no, I was in 212.
Okay,
the last hardest Bud class on the history of Buds.
Yeah, right now our class, 2-6 is last hardest Bud class. No.
Yeah.
No, when I got there, you know, I was just like, okay, I want to be a SEAL. I need to figure out, because I didn't have anybody train me, teach me anything.
Yeah.
I'm on a Marine base. I'm in a barracks, and Camp Pendleton is massive. So I'm in the middle of nowhere, and I needed to figure it out on my own. So I got the documentary. I bought fins. I would go to the gym that was like down the street from the barracks, and I didn't know how to work out. I would just create workouts from what I saw in the Buzz 2-3 video, like circuit training and keep.
Yeah.
And I did that. And then I would run 3 miles to the pool. And I jumped in the shallow end, of course. And I was like, I need to figure this out. And and the lifeguards would be looking at me like, oh, man.
They're like God
I'm
damn
trying
it, Remy's
dry
back
today. Man. I'm trying to stay dry. This dude's going to make me get wet. And I just started out in the shallow end. And then finally I went to my LPO at the time. And I said, listen, like, because I was getting off at 4 o'clock, and I said, "Listen, if I can have the afternoon off, I could really take that time to prepare for Buzz." And she believed in me. You know, she believed. I've had a lot of women in my life who's come in my life who's really either they believed in me and they've helped me in a significant way that's helped me to get to where I'm at today. My mom, Tiana, and my first LPO, HM2 Brown. And she was like, "All right, so I would work." She changed my schedule, so I would work 4 hours in the morning, 8 to 12. I would have 12 to 4 off to train, and then I would work the night clinic from like 4 to 8, something like that.
It's a long day, but
yeah,
it's awesome that they carved that time out for you.
Yeah, 100%. And I just crushed it, man. I checked in January 2004. I failed the screening test because I failed the swim by like a minute in like May of 2004. And it's gone from like not being able to swim, skinny, and I had qualified. I had retaken the ASVAB. I had studied the ASVAB book in that time. And then I passed in July of 2004.
Wow.
And I got orders to Buds. I was in Buds in January. No, sorry, 2003. Sorry. Checked in January 2003. Took the first screen in May 2003. Passed it in July 2003. I was in Buds January 2004. So within a year checking in my command, I was checking out and I went to Buds.
That's pretty crazy trajectory, given where you started.
Yeah, I was like balls to the wall. But the thing was, and this kind of goes into why I really struggled the first time in Buds with the water was, I didn't know that we did 2 mile time ocean swims in Buds. Like literally, I was like,
It was still a largely an information gap. In
yeah.
Like I remember when I went to my Navy recruiter, mm-hmm. they handed me like this Maybe there was a staple in it, so it was more than one piece of paper, but it was like this pyramid of push-ups. And like running it, like the amount of information. I had a female Navy recruiter as well. She was actually a mechanic for the Blue Angels, was her duty station before, and I believe she went back.
Oh, wow.
But she wasn't versed in the SEAL, and we're talking 95 when I signed up. 96 is when I actually went to boot camp, so there was not a lot of information. There was no, I don't think I knew we did 2 mile swims either. I didn't care because that was actually my strength.
Which was good then.
Yeah. But you get to Buds and you're like, hey, does anybody know anything?
Nobody knew nothing.
You see a brown shirt and you're like, can I take you out to breakfast?
Yeah.
For people listening, brown shirts, it means you made it through Hell Week. So therefore you know everything.
No, 100%. Yeah, you are God, man.
Yeah. So it was the 2 mile ocean swims that got you?
Yeah, when I showed up. Because I didn't know that we did 2 mile time ocean swims. I just thought I needed to pass the screening test. And then when I went to Buds, it was just like, oh, you know, push-ups, runs, pull, like all that stuff. I didn't, old course. And so I remember the first day of first phase. We did some stuff at NDOC in the pool, but the first open water swim I had done in my entire life was the first day of first wetsuit appreciation swim in the bay.
Which is... we get you really cold, so you appreciate your wetsuit. It's exactly what people think it is.
It's freezing cold, man. It's freezing cold. This is February.
Yeah. You started Buds the same time. I was a January start as well.
Yeah.
I know you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's waves, there's tides, there's
freezing,
rip currents. And none of that is present in pools.
No, none of that.
So not only the ability to swim, now you're talking about managing the surf.
Exactly.
I know what you're talking about.
And his pool is a little bit warmer. And so I jumped.
The pool is steaming in the morning.
Exactly, exactly.
The ocean is not.
And I don't know what it is, if it's the chlorine or what it is, but like it felt like this. When you're swimming with fins, you move a lot better. And obviously it's because of the absence of the current, but I don't know. Anyway, the first open water swim, wetsuit appreciation swim, And I chose my swim buddy was a dude named Tyrone Peters, another black dude. It's three black dudes in the class. Out of a class of 250 cats, and I choose a swim buddy to be another black dude, right? So we get, and he had been in Buds before.
Okay.
And so we get into the water, and I'm kicking like, dude, I'm kicking like never before. I'm going nowhere. Like nowhere, and Peterson is screaming at him like because he's getting ahead of me. Hey, Lake, what you doing? Come on! I was like, I'm swimming, man. I'm trying, and I'm kicking, and I'm getting cold. I had no body fat, so I'm getting cold, and so my body's starting to lock up. And then all of a sudden, I start looking up, and I'm seeing like instructors staring at me
in the boat,
the safety boats.
Yeah,
and they're like, what the hell are you doing? And I was like, is like, no.
They're like, none of this.
Cut the
and for people listening, huya is the answer to everything when you're a student.
Yeah.
It means yes, no, maybe,
I don't
fuck
know.
You, I don't know. It means everything. Mm-hmm. And as an instructor, it gets very irritating because you'll ask a question, what you legitimately, are you okay?
Yeah.
Like people freezing to death. They'll go, huya, instructor stuff. And you're like, no.
Yeah.
Are you okay?
Yeah. Yeah, no, 100%. 100%. And they're like, cut it. We need an answer. How the hell did you show up to SEAL training and not know how to swim? I was just like, hooyah. They was like, no. Yeah,
we're past the hooyah
phase.
We're
past it. And it was like, well, just keep going. And I didn't get far. I didn't get far at all. I mean, obviously, the point of the drill wasn't the time swim or anything like that, but it was just one of those things where you just had, it was completion. They just wanted to use the elements to get you cold. And after that swim, that's when I was like, man, like, what did I sign up for, bro? Like, I knew I wasn't going to quit, but I knew I was just like, I'm in a world of hurt, man.
And let's remind people, this is your first day.
Day one. Day one. But the good thing about it was that was the last evolution of the day. So I had done the morning PT and the log PT and the boats on heads and all that. But
first
that
day of first phase is a shit show,
it's
by
a kick
the way.
In the nuts, man.
By design. Yeah. It's basically you're going to look into a shotgun barrel and have somebody else pull the trigger.
Exactly. That's a perfect description of it.
Yeah, you're like eyeballing. You're like, boom.
Yeah.
Yeah, by design.
Yeah.
The attrition on day one is actually startling.
Yeah. No, it's high. It's high. Like, what, 20, 30 per people per class? Winter class.
And what's crazy is, you'd think they did a little research before showing up.
Yeah.
You'd think that they know it's going to be hard.
Yeah.
The number of people that will quit in the first few hours,
I remember,
as an instructor, still consistently surprised me. Like, what did you expect?
I don't get it. What I boil it down to, I think it's they don't have a deep-rooted emotional reason why. I think a lot of
they don't understand their why of why they're there. No. Yeah, I would agree with you on
that.
They
have a superficial reason.
Yeah,
they have a reason, but it's a superficial reason. And it's like, oh, I want to you know, grow out my hair. I want to wear a trident. I want chicks to like me.
Hey, you've heard the same saying I have. Yeah. Everybody wants to be a frogman on Friday.
Exactly. Yeah, you know the deal. Yeah. And when they get smashed in the mouth,
yeah,
that's when it's like that good idea quickly turns into a bad idea. Yeah. And for me, my deep root of what kept me going, especially after that first swim, was I have nothing left. Like
nothing left to go back to?
I have failed at so much in life. I failed at being a son. I failed at being a brother. I failed at music. I failed at, you know, hustling. I can't fail anymore. So that was my deep-rooted, I'm going to keep hanging. I'm not going to quit. So anyway, you know, get through the first week, second week, 2 mile time ocean swim. Passing time's 85 minutes. I do it 120 minutes.
And for people listening, there's a 2 mile ocean swim. Yeah. Buds is a 26 week course.
Yep.
There's 26 of them. Yep. I think they do them, what is it? Mondays are the time runs.
Yep. Tuesdays.
Tuesdays are the swims. Yep. And Wednesdays are the O course.
Yep.
You could set your watch to it. You're good.
And two of those, and one of those 26 swims is 3.5 miles, and another one is 5.5
Correct.
Miles.
Yeah. Right? And the times. Decrease yep. per phase. Not a crazy amount,
yeah,
but
5 minutes, right?
Yeah, about 5 minutes. I think it's 2 minutes on the O course.
Yeah, 2 minutes on O course. Yeah. And it's like a minute or is it a minute for the run? I can't remember.
It's reasonable though. Because if you make it to those phases, you are actually getting more than anything, it's efficiency.
Yeah, yeah.
The students are just better at doing it. But yeah, you can set your watch to the number of times you're gonna have to get in for the old 2 miler.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh yeah. and I dread it like every night.
Of course you did.
It's like, yo, man, this is going because like literally toward halfway through the swim, one, I was last. Like I was in the back. And then like about, I would say the last quarter mile of the swim, I would begin to get hypothermia.
Even in the in the wetsuits?
Yeah, in the wetsuits. Because I had no body fat. And remember, I'm swimming 2 hours. 120, the passing time is 85 minutes. Yeah. Like I'm in,
so you're basically doing a one and a half.
Exactly. Exactly. And I remember one time I felt so bad because I was in, Mikey Mansour was in my boat crew, Workman was in my boat crew. There's a lot of good dudes. And I remember one time Peterson looked up because he was guiding and he was looking at the beach and the entire class is getting hammered. And Peterson is like, Remy, everybody's getting hammered because of us. Like the instructors told me that if Remy doesn't quit, we're going to just hammer the class until he finishes the swim.
Classic instructor technique. I support that.
Yes. And I felt so bad, but I just, it was bad, man. But I finished the swim and the class, like, they did respect me because after the swims, they'd be like, yo, man, like, we feel bad for you, bro. but you're a hard dude. Like, because I put out in everything else.
That's the thing. It wasn't a matter of whether or not you were hard.
Yeah.
You just, you didn't have enough experience under your belt when it came to swimming.
No. And so anyway, I get to Hell Week. I survived. The instructor's like, dang, this dude made it to Hell Week. Like, this dude's, he's crazy. So I get to Hell Week and the med checks, I'm spitting up blood. Like, we did med checks on like a Thursday, I think, or Friday or something like that. Hell Week started on Sunday, and I'm spitting up blood. And as a corpsman, I knew I had pneumonia or SIPE. SIPE is, for people don't know, swim-induced pulmonary edema.
Basically water in your lungs, right?
Yeah. And like, a lot of guys get it in buds because of how much we're in the water. And so I knew what it was. But I was just like, I can't go back to day one again. I can't do day one.
Especially if it's Thursday or Friday. I mean, you can almost see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, yeah. And so after that, I pushed through. I pushed through, went into Hell Week, and then when I say med check, the med check before the start of Hell Week. So the med check was on Thursday, Friday was down day or whatever, and then you had Saturday to chill, and then Sunday was breakout.
Yeah, so, come in around midday and just hang out.
So by the time Sunday came, I'm really spitting up a lot of blood. I start Hell Week, Hurt Locker Monday, still pushing, crushing it. Tuesday, bro, like I get hypothermia, pneumonia. My pneumonia got worse, but I got hypothermia during steel pier. My core temperature was 88.8. Like, it was bad. They rushed me to medical, got to medical. That's when I finally confessed. I was just like, listen, dude, like, I got sight. And I spit up blood and like there was like jello into the basin. And the doctor at the time, I had known his wife because his wife was a doctor at my first duty station, and he had actually gave me a tour of Buds like before I even came to Buds. And so we had like this, I don't want to call it a personal relationship, but we kind of were like cool. And I think he thought that I was trying, because you know, you get all the people who fake injuries or they say I'm hurting or they, and there's nothing wrong with them. I think he thought I was taking advantage of the fact that I knew him. And he looked at me, he's like, hey, like, it's not that bad what you got. Like, you need to go back to Hell Week. Like, this is just business. Like, you got to go back to Hell Week. You can't get out of it. Like, so long story short, I went back into Hell Week, you know, a few hours after they rewarmed me. And I remember Fortin, seeing you for instructor Fortin. Yeah, as soon as I get back to the class, he's like, hey, Remi, do you want to, Adeleke, he's like, do you want to quit or do you want to go in the water? Because I know, I heard you got pulled out because you were cold. And I was like, nah, I'm going to go in the water. I went in the water, freezing cold. We did Around the World, and during Around the World, bass tour. During bass tour, like, I'm running, and then, like, all I remember is I'm running 1 minute, and then I'm on, and I don't even remember hitting the ground. What the instructors, everybody told me, is just like, Remi, it was like somebody pulled the light switch out the socket. I went from this, bam, face planted. Like, I was done. And they did the sternum rub to kind of bring me back to, rush me to medical. They took chest x-rays this time. They was like, yo, your lungs are shredded. Like, my lungs were just,
you're like,
shredded.
No, asshole, I told you that the last time I was here.
Yeah, yeah. the whole medical got in trouble because a dude died in my class. Yeah,
no shit. Was it the
Rob
guy
Vetter?
Was it the guy who aspirated in the pool?
No, he died on a run. Rob Vetter. He was a swick dude. He had a heart attack,
didn't he?
Yeah, on a conditioning run.
Yeah.
So Buds had already, and I can't remember all the history behind it. I don't know if he had something going on that he kind of hit or what.
I think
was going
it
on
was pre, it was a combination of both. Yeah. I don't know if he was 100% honest on the entry paperwork, and I don't, and I think there was an aspect of the medical staff might have missed something as well.
Yeah.
Either way, it terminated in him. Face down, fucking dead.
Yeah,
on the conditioning.
Yeah, he died. Yeah, I was one of the corpsmen that helped tend to him. You know, because they could. Somebody called corpsman up. I ran.
Yeah.
So, Bud's medical was already under the microscope because of that. And when that happened, that just changed things. But I was in the ICU for 4 days, man.
Oh shit.
Yeah, dude. I had pneumonia and sight, and I had rhabdo, and I was just a mess, bro. Like, I was on antibiotics, and then and obviously the chafe and all the other stuff that comes with it. And when I got out of medical, went back to Buds, you know, the Master Chief, what was his name? Master Chief Hoffman. No, Senior Chief Hoffman. And the rest of the guys were just like, dang, bro, like, we didn't know. Like, we're sorry. Like, we thought you were faking. Because they see, and I
they
and,
see
and,
a
and
very
respect,
high volume of fakers.
I mean, you know the deal. You was a Buds instructor, man. Like, you, and I've seen all the guys who fake, oh, I'm hurting. It's like, no, you just don't want to quit.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I could kind of understand. And there was like, hey, good on you for pushing through. Bad news is you got to start all over day one.
Fuck.
So, dude,
so you got a med roll.
I got a med roll. Day one, watched 100 plus dudes quit in 251. I was in boat crew with Mark Lee. It's crazy though, man. I was like, I met all these awesome frogs, man. I was able to serve with, and even though it was just Buds, like, serve with all these awesome, these legends. I mean, you know, and went through first phase, failed all the swims again. went to Hell Week, made it through Hell Week, and then after I made it through Hell Week, the CO was just like, and the XO, Ryan Zinke, was just like, all right, you know, we see that you got the heart. We're not even going to let you go into second phase. We're not even going to let you do the last swim in first phase. We're just going to roll you now.
So you got a med roll to start with, then a performance roll.
And they double roll me. It was like, we know we're setting you up for failure if you get rolled one time. So we're just going to double roll you.
Yeah. And for people listening, you do get one medical roll and one performance roll.
Yep.
You do not. So you can get a total of two rolls, but it can't be the same kind.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if it had been two meds, and I've been on those boards, it's like, hey, man, we're sorry, but.
Yeah.
Your balance. But either way, your last silver bullet was fired when they double rolled you.
Yeah, because they were like, you cannot swim. We're not going to be able to teach you in 8 weeks, bro. They was like, you need like 6 months. So they double rolled me. I was in brown shirt rollback land, worked the Hell Weeks and all that stuff. And then class back up with 253. And then I passed my first swim. It's like, yes, dude, I'm like, I'm not a moron. Like, I could do it. Passed my first swim. And I get to second phase. And I failed my first swim.
And was it of time, obviously?
Yeah, it was time, but a lot of it was pride. It was more so pride than anything, because on the weekends, the instructors would show up, and you know this. Yep. I mean, you did it. You would show up on the weekends, and you would to on your off time to do remediation to help guys who were struggling. And after I had made it through Hell Week and I passed my first swim, like, my pride level went from here to, like, here.
Like, I don't know if you know this, guys, but I basically already have my trident.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, that's how I was. I was telling girls at the club, I'm a frog man.
Yeah, I'm kind of a big deal. You might have heard of me.
Yeah, I was still, like, I was partying. I was going down to Gas Lamp District. Because in my mind, I was like, hey, I'm this kid from Africa, lost everything, went to the Bronx, hustling
past
the streets.
One goddamn swim, and
yeah,
here I am.
Past one swim, I'm a, you know, and I thought I had arrived, right? And, you know, I was just, it was my pride. And I tell people all the time, man, you know, pride is dangerous, man, because it can crush you. And
what's the saying? Pride before the fall?
Pride before the fall, man. And it crushed me. And, you know, I was too hungover to show up to remediation. And I was, and a part of it was like, I don't need it anymore, you know? And I think that if I would have really showed up to those remediations and continued working on my swims and then the other stuff as it related to pool week, I would have made it through. But, you know, shoulda, coulda, woulda. So anyway, I get in a dive phase, fail my first swim, fail my second swim. Go to an ARB board. They're like, if you fail another swim, we're kicking you out of boards.
And they don't have a choice, by the way. Yeah. Again, having been on that board, yeah, we flip open the record and it's like, listen,
yeah,
there's nothing we can do.
It's, yeah, 100%. And so I get to pool week, and that tread, bro. I mean, you know the deal with the tread.
I know the deal with the tread.
You know the deal with the tread, bro. And I'm already struggling. I mean, I passed Ditch and Don, Night Ditch and Don, Buddy Gear, Shane Gear.
But you
that.
Still were failing the tread, every day, weren't you?
Dude, I thought I was like, yo, when they
So for the people listening, the tread, 1080 scuba tanks. Mm-hmm. With a manifold and regulator that Jacques Cousteau would be disgusted with because it was from, like, the days of the Egyptians.
Yeah, man.
You have a weight belt on.
Yeah.
You have your UDT fins, and you start a clock.
Yep.
Bottom of the wrist has to be out of the water.
Yep.
Both hands up.
Yep.
And that's the only requirement.
That's
5 minutes.
5 minutes, bro. And when they threw me in that water, I was like, yo, what are they trying to do to me? They trying to kill me, man. It's like all this weight. I could, my leg strength when it came to swimming was not up to par anyway. And it's like, I got to tread water for
And this
five
is a
minutes.
Different type of swimming. This is completely vertical.
Vertical.
Yeah. You know, if you flip it on your side and you're doing the underwater recovery stroke.
Yeah.
I mean, you could literally sleep doing that.
Exactly.
But you flip that vertical, put a little bit of weight on there. And if people, I mean, I would watch it. They'd have their weight belt on cockeyed. So they're starting to list.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, man. Oh. It was, I'm not going to lie. As an instructor, it was fucking glorious.
I bet.
All I would watch is their hands.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If they were, you know, most people would figure out if they just kind of lean forward and put their head in the water, they relax and they'll tread for a little bit, come up,
breathe,
big breath, and come back down. But you just watch the hands, and it starts like when they start monkey pawing.
Oh, it's a rat. It's fucking on. It's a matter of time, dude.
And you'd see weird, like the Texas Longhorns, and then if, like you just all I would do is watch the fingers.
Yeah,
and at some point. You realize it's fucking giddy up time.
Oh yeah, it's a wrap. Somebody's going down, and then even when you drop your hands, the instructor's like, "Oh, stay in the water." Like,
yeah, you still got to
stay in
the
water. It's like, no, dude, I can't. I swallowed like 10 gallons of water. But
I would
have
students drop their weight belt on me, and I would go down and get it.
I never did that.
And I would wrap it over their manifold so they couldn't take it off again.
Yikes. How do you even get it off at that point?
Because it's still got that quick release. They lower their hands.
That's right. Yeah,
they
yeah,
drop
yeah.
it, and then all of a sudden they're doing a tread, like nipples are out of the water.
Yeah,
I'm like,
no.
Be right back. Drape it over the manifold, and then fuck me.
Yeah.
That's the widest eyes I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, man. So, I
the tread got you.
I failed the first time, failed the second time, went to ARB board. Hey, you know, we're going to have a discussion if you fail it, you know.
Because you get four shots at
it. Yep.
Yep.
Failed the third time, failed the fourth time.
Fuck, man. And like I said, the instructor's hands are tied at that point.
Yeah. And they told me, I went to my ARB board for that fourth failure. They told me if you'd have passed your first two swims, like, we would have rolled you. You know, because you're a good dude, we would have rolled you. But you failed your first two swims, and now this, we got to drop you. And that was the first time I took responsibility. Like, I remember they asked me, they said, you got anything to say? And I was just like, hey, man, real talk. Like, I'm not even trying to, like, you know, shine you guys on or anything, but it's my fault. I was just like, I should have been working on what I needed to work on the weekend. I should have been, you know, going to remediation on the weekend. I took full responsibility. And that was where I really learned that lesson, is that in order for you to progress in life after failure, first and foremost, you gotta take responsibility for it. You can't.
It's a tough lesson to learn, man.
Yeah. Because my whole life, I blamed everybody for everything, like everything. That was the first time in my adult life I took the blame. And that's where I learned, you know, a failure is only a failure if you don't learn from it. If you learn from it, it's a lesson. And the lesson that I got out of that was, one, never show up to anything in life unprepared. Like, I showed up to Buds unprepared. And two, like...
And if you do that, the system will work.
Yeah.
I mean, if that curriculum is designed to spit people out for those reasons.
100%. And
so where'd you go in the in
first
Mar
Div? So I ended up with the Marines after all.
First Mar Div.
Yeah, man. So I ended up first Mar Div.
Was that back in Camp Pendleton?
Back to Camp Pendleton. And, you know... It was. I needed that though. I needed that, and I was with the. I was with the grunts. I was at Battalion 1-4, and I hated it. like, cause you know, no disrespect to the Marines. Marines are awesome. Like, I love my Marines. I just do.
They're a different breed, though.
Yeah, they're different breed. I love them, but it was just it wasn't what I wanted. You know, when you feel like you were so close to what you want, and then you end up where you don't want to be. It just,
I mean,
it,
dude, if
things.
You made it to pool week, you're about halfway through the curriculum.
Yeah,
maybe not light at the end of the tunnel,
but
you're marking your progress towards completion.
Yeah, man. And so anyway, man, I went there, you know, a lot of amazing events happened. My LPO, I was there for like a year and a half. My LPO ended up becoming the command career counselor. Like, the command career counselor for 1st Marine Division. And he had known my work ethic. He saw me work hard. He knew I wanted to go back to Buds. And so he was just like, hey, I talked to the command master chief. And keep in mind, he went from being in charge of like 10 corpsmen to being in charge of like 600 corpsmen.
Yeah, all the corpsmen.
For every corpsman for 1st Marine Division. And he was just like, hey, dude, like, I'm going to talk to the master chief. And he talked to master chief. Master chief was, first he said no, but then master chief came back and said, listen, if he gets his FMF pin and he has good evals, and he signs a page 13 that says if he fails Buds, he will have to come back and do 3 full years or do the full tour, I will allow him to go to Buds. And I went back to Buds, man, and 266. And, you know.
Straight through that time?
Straight through.
You got rolled again?
I got rolled in third phase. Third phase.
What for this time? Don't say swims, goddammit.
No. Demo.
Yeah,
I failed the demo test, man.
You did?
Yeah, man.
Damn it, Remi.
I know.
So how
I think
was...
you got on me about that, too, when you found out. Because I got back and off the island, and you was like, dude, Remi, like, what the hell did you get rolled for? And I said, demo. He was like, demo? Like, I failed the test. But anyway, you know, again, it was good for me, man. Again, and every failure has been good for me because I learned a lesson in it, you know, and...
How was Hell Week through, second time, or the easy, third man. Time through, yeah.
It was easy.
You think
was,
because you knew it was coming?
Yeah, I knew it was coming, and I had been through it already, and it was just like...
You passed the tread on your first try?
No. Dude, you should know this story.
Fuck. I saw a lot of students.
Okay, yeah, that's true. So his...
If I had known you had this history with the tread...
Yeah.
Don't mistake it. I would have grabbed you out of line and been like, Remi, let's fucking party.
No, I know. Dude, you probably don't remember this, but Instructor Kraft...
I remember Kraft, yeah.
He was there when I was in dive phase the first time. So he had told all the instructors, like, we're going to get. So anyway, the first time I do the tread, like, Kraft is like, you're going to go first. I was like, all right, yeah, I'm good. I can go first.
And probably better that you do.
Yeah.
Get that fucker done.
Yeah, get it over with. And I rushed the straps on, and he's like, hey, get in the water. Go now. I was like, hey, I just want to get my straps right. And I jump in the water, and I do the tread 5 minutes. Boom. I'm good. I'm looking at Kraft like, yeah.
Looking at me like, are you guys seeing this? Yeah, are you guys seeing this tread?
Yeah. but then, because I hastily put on the straps towards like the last 30 seconds of the tread, the straps begin to get looser,
no.
Right? But they stay on, four or five minutes. So, boom. Now it's time to do the swim. You got to do the swim down.
Yep.
I do the swim down. The strap pops. Like, when I'm halfway down, like passing a dive board, the strap comes off and it wraps around my neck, but it's still on. And they're like, I can't remember if it was you and like, you still ain't failed, dude. Tanks are still on your back, technically. Like, keep going.
Yeah, I'd let you party.
So I'm still swimming and it's like choking me. So I'm like, I'm pulling, it's yanking on my neck. And I'm like, damn, man. So I get, right before I get to the ledge, I was like, man, when I get on my back, like, these things are going to come off. Because, like, gravity, right? You know, just the water just...
They're just naturally going to sink. They're going to tip
fall off. Yeah, like, because it's only one strap and it's hanging on by a thread at this point. And lo and behold, like, I start swimming backwards on my back. I'm feeling good. It comes off. And Instructor Kraft was like, Adeleke, fail. Dude, I got out the water. Dude, you should remember this, man. I got out the water and I flipped out on crack. Like, the instructor, I can't remember who was there. It was like, Adeleke, drop down. Who the hell you think you talk to? Because I was like... I was like, I told you, man. I told you my straps weren't jacked up, dude.
I think I do remember that interaction.
I was like, I told you my freaking, like, I'm cursing. Like, I told you my freaking straps were messed up. Like, dude, my instructors were like, Adeleke, drop the fuck down. Who you think you're talking to, brother? And I dropped down. I'm still like, I told him. I was like, I'm wanting to drive there wet. I'm like, I told him my straps were jacked up, man. Like, I could pass this. And they was like, dude, you failed. It's like, you showed you could pass it. Just come back and do it tomorrow. So I came back the next day, failed it the second time.
No fucking way.
Yeah, bro. It's like a movie, bro. It's like perfect tension plot twist, right? So I get in the water, like, boom, do the 5 minutes. I'm good. Swim down, straps, everything was good. Swim down, good. Swim back, shallow water blackout. Like, right when I was passing the second.
No shit.
Yeah, man, that's what I'm saying. Like, I think you, like, a bunch of instructors jumped in the water to get me out because I'm swimming. And I passed like the first or the second.
I do think I helped pull you out.
Yeah, and because it was like, man, it was you. Because you was like, man, you were heavy.
Your eyes rolled into the fucking back of your head.
Yeah, I had a blackout.
Yeah, you were heavy.
And I went all the way down there, and dudes were like trying to swim my negative ass up, dude. I was just like, it was a wrap. The instructors were like, yo, I think you looked at me like, yo, man, like, good on you, but you failed, bro.
Yeah. The only evolution you get a shallow water blackout pass on is the 50 meter underwater.
Yeah, yeah. I failed, though. I failed, so I failed and went to a board. Like,
you're like, what's up, bitches? I'm back.
But yeah, I know. It was like surreal, dude. So, but it was like a bunch of you brought everybody. Like, the instructors brought every, like, all the guys who failed like two times or whatever into the board. It was like a phase board, and then you cleared everybody out after you flipped on them like, oh, you suck. Yeah. And then they're like, Adeleke, stay here. I stayed in there. It was like, yo, dude, like, come on, dude, like, like, we know you can do this. All right, just go there. Tomorrow,
yeah.
Do the swim. We know you can pass it. Just get it over with and freaking move on. And I did. Went in, passing, no shallow water blackout, no straps. Went through pool. You were my first pool comp.
How'd that go?
You failed me. Even I thought I passed. I was mad at you. I'm not going to lie. I was mad because I did everything right.
What did I fail you for? Procedure?
I can't remember what it was for. It was the pool comp where it's like a hoo-ya pool comp. Not a hoo-ya, but it's like the one that's like a practice type, but if you pass it, you pass it. You know what I'm saying? Did that exist back then? You remember? Like, it's the full-on pool comp, but it's like...
I don't remember one that was like that. It was either pool comp or it wasn't.
Okay, so anyway, it was pool comp then. You were the first instructor that I went through and you kicked me in the nuts. Drowning.
And then you were mad at me.
I was mad, bro. I was mad because I felt like I did everything right. I was like, man, no, I passed it. But you were known to be the hardest, one of the hardest. No,
I gave a very fair test.
But
it was difficult.
But everybody's like, yo, don't go on instructor stumps line. Don't go on instructor stumps line for the pool comp. You're gonna get crushed. And
I mean, I thought the test should be hard, but it should be fair.
Yeah.
If people pass, they pass. Yeah. If they fail, they failed.
Yeah.
I didn't take any personal interest.
No, you didn't. Yeah. You didn't. You didn't. 100%. You didn't. It was all business. And you know, I failed, but it was good. Second time I passed it.
Yeah.
Passed it.
And most people do not pass on their first attempt anyway.
Yeah.
The odds of success increase. Actually, most people, over half, are usually on their third attempt.
Yeah.
When it gets to the fourth, the stats start going down in touch.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. 100. Because he's stressed out.
Oh,
like,
my God.
Like,
you see him on the side of the pool, and they're just like, fuck. I'm actually going to have to work for my money on this
exactly,
one.
Exactly.
They freak out.
And that's why I didn't want to get to that. I was just like, nope. Like, I wanted to pass. That's why I wanted to pass for a second. I was like, I'm passing it now, dude. Like, because that stress on top of the stress being in the water, not being able to breathe and all that. Nah, that's not happening. So, yeah, went through and then got to third phase and, you know, had the mishap, came back, made it through third phase, and went to SQT, and then I had a massive setback in SQT, and that's been my whole life, man. Like, even up to this point, dude, just getting punched in the mouth by life. Like, got to static line jump school, and, you know, on the first jump, you know, jump, second jump, the winds were super high. It was the end of the day.
Was this out in Otay?
Yeah. This is static. This was out Brownfield.
Yeah. Brown, okay. Otay? Oh, that's
yeah,
right.
Brownfield, yeah.
Yep.
And
Trident DZ.
Yeah, Trident DC. And I was the number two guy out, and I guess the guy I was a slight might have been slightly heavier than the one guy, but I don't know what happened with the weights, but I fell past the one guy and I became the number one guy, but because of the horizon and everything, it was hard to tell, like,
yeah,
you're not paying attention to who's the one, two.
Well, and static line jumping is a shit show anyway. You have very little control.
It's dumb.
And that's the most apt description of that activity.
Yeah, I hate it, dude. I hate it. And so I pass him, and as I'm getting closer towards the ground, because the winds are massively high at this point, we all have the radios on, and the instructor just starts screaming, number two guy, you need to turn into the wind. You're not into the wind. And I'm like, I was the number two guy in my mind, but in reality, at that point, I wasn't. I was the number one guy from his POV.
Yeah, the exit stick order was different than your actual vertical.
Exactly, exactly. And so he starts screaming frantically, like, you need to turn into the wind, number two guy. So in my mind, I'm already into the wind, but I'm like, maybe he knows something I don't know. This is just my second static line jump. I go to turn, and dude, I the wind shifted my chute, and I was sideways at this point, and if I tried to counter, I could have landed sideways and just really jacked myself up, and you know, so I just stuck with it, and I hit the ground massively hard. I split my medial malleolus, the bone in my ankle, in half. Yeah, dude. Like, as soon as I hit the ground, I heard my ankle snap, crackle, and pop, bro. And it was just like, oh shit, dude.
The number of times I've been on a static line DZ, where you hear people after they land yell, "Corman!"
Yeah.
It's not awesome.
No, it's
that
not.
That activity should be fucking outlawed.
It should be banned. Yeah, no, 100%, dude, 100%.
You have no control. You're coming down at a high rate of speed. Mm-hmm. It's crazy.
Yo, it's
and you know how many times SEALs have ever done a successful static line jump in real life?
And this is the sign. Zero. Not for 3-0. Not for 3-0.
Zero.
I can't make the proper.
Yeah.
But yeah, man. And but I didn't call for Corman, because at that point I was just
Well, you had already diagnosed it yourself.
Yeah,
you
already knew. Yeah, I was just like, damn, bro. I was like, I just need to do two more jumps. So do I go to the hospital or do I do these last two jumps? So long story short, dude, I ended up, you know, hiding the injury. The next day, did the last two jumps on it broken. And then, you know, and then
I had to deal
to
with
the
that.
Hospital. But I got my cert and,
yeah,
you know, got out and got rolled, and then, you know, class back up with 269 and graduated and went to the teams, man. And then I think you were three when I was there, right?
I think so, yeah. I checked in to team three in 08.
Okay, yeah.
So you probably were in the OIF portion of that? You deployed to Iraq?
Yep, Iraq.
Okay. So was Nick your OIC?
We were in the same TU.
Okay, yeah, so you were in probably a sister platoon?
Yeah, I was in Delta. He was in Charlie.
Okay, so I was over in Afghanistan. So yeah, we ended up. How was your experience in the teams?
Great, man. Like, great. Oh, I loved the teams, man. Like, I was able to, you know, do some cool stuff and serve with awesome guys, in my opinion. You know what I mean? You know, total, like, I was able to do three deployments, and, you know, it was just great. I don't have any negative experience with the teams. Like, I was able to, you know, kick down doors. And
was it what you thought it was going to be?
For the most part, yes. For the most part, yes. On the DA side of things, yes.
Yeah. Like, being direct action people kicking indoors.
Yeah, being able to do DAs, and granted, they weren't like I wasn't doing a DA every day, but like, to be able to do, like, just being able to go on one DA, you know, like the first DA I went on, I was just like, dude, this is the teams, bro. Like, sneaking in, kicking down the door, wrapping the dude up, like, yes. Like, and I remember after my first op, I was just like, I could die now. Like, in my opinion, you know what I mean? There's guys who have done way more stuff than I will ever do, you know what I mean? Like, but just in my mindset, coming from where I came from in life to get to that point, it was story arc filmed over now for me, you know what I mean? And I don't mean that in a negative way. I just mean, like, man, like, I made it, you know? And it was great. You know, I was a corpsman, and then I was also a HUMINT guy. So, you know, I did a lot of the human intelligence stuff, you know, and that was fun. So I was able to, you know, I don't know how much I could share here, but like. Yeah.
I feel like your background and all this stuff that led up in that life, hustling on the street.
Oh, yeah.
Had to have helped when it came to interfacing with people like that.
100%. 100%.
And for people listening, we're largely talking about developing networks of human intelligence.
Yeah.
And I'd probably just leave it at that. But, so, those interpersonal skills, the ability to read people, communicate, manipulate them if you need to. Exactly. Yeah, like that shit's going to be huge.
Oh, 100%. 100%. And, you know, I felt like coming from the Bronx and being and the big piece of it was I learned how to read people in the Bronx.
Like, that's what I'm saying.
This dude's fake. This dude's a killer. This dude's this. So as soon as I'm in a meeting and somebody's like, blah, 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 I'm like looking at them like, come on, bro. Like,
yeah. You know, I'm fucking three steps ahead of you.
I'm three steps. But here's another thing I was able to do, which was funny. Because this, I mean, as you know, like, what is it? Like less than 1% of SEALs are African-American, something like that?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's
probably.
Last statistic I saw was something along those lines. And then when you get into the human side of things, there's not many African-Americans in that, right? So like, when I would meet with these people, they so used to seeing the white faces with the beards, right? I would walk in, they was like, like who? Like, who's this dude? Like, who's this? But I use it to my advantage. I remember I began to learn that a lot of the people, and I'm just trying to be vague here, but a lot of the civilians that I work with in other countries, you know, they like black movies, like Eddie, they like Eddie Murphy and comedies and all this other stuff. They didn't understand, but they would watch because they get the Arabic versions and they would watch like Eddie Murphy. And all. So when I started to get hip to the game, I was like, oh, let me start acting. So I remember I would go in a meeting sometimes, like, yo, what's up? And just act like Eddie Murphy. And dude, they couldn't understand what I was saying, but they would like a big cheese salad. But I would just use that to build common ground and build relationship. And then that helped me be more effective in the job that I did, man. So
you're a product of your upbringing, yeah, as we all are, man. When you said you went down the human route, my initial thought was like, oh, fuck, man. Everything that you went through in your life probably made you awesome at that.
And for me, it was the best of both worlds because, you know, I was able to, you know, build these intelligence packages, communicate with people, and then take that and then go on ops.
Help,
you know. And I wasn't the only one. Like, there was a whole team that worked together to do it, and there were other ways of information that we had to vet against and all that stuff. So it was a whole system behind it. But to be a part of that and then also be a part of the other side.
Yeah, that's awesome. You know,
it was cool.
I mean, so like you said, the statistics on African-Americans in the SEAL teams are super low. What's your answer when people ask you, do the SEAL teams need more diversity?
I think diversity is great. I think I would say, in short, yes. I would say the SEAL teams can be more diverse, but I think that how do we get there is the question. And I think it has to do, one, with, it starts way before the SEAL teams. I mean, in my opinion, I think it starts with education, especially in communities that are predominantly, you know, minority communities. You know, I just think that it starts there. I think this education, just case in point, like my brother is a doctor. You know, it's not as many black doctors as there are white doctors, right?
Yeah.
My other brother is an engineer. It's not that many, you know, black engineers as there are white engineers, right? So I think that one, and then a big part of that is what is 70% of Americans are white Caucasian, right?
I think so, yeah.
It's like 14% are African-American, so that plays a huge role in everything as well. I just think it goes back to, again, education, you know, the education system in these inner cities, exposing kids to soft, exposing kids to not just the soft, but other career choices. I think also fixing the education in inner cities where it's up to par. I have a friend who's a recruiter now. We were in the Navy, and he left the Navy. Now he's in the Army, and he's a recruiter in Philly. And he's called me up twice, and he's just like, man, Remi, like, I can't get any of these kids in the military. I'm like, wow, what's going on? He's like, the schools are so jacked up, some of these kids can't even read.
So able to get to the baseline for entry into the military.
Yeah, they can't even get entry into the military. And then he's like, some of these kids have records and this and that. But his main focus was the education system. And he was just like, man, like what can you do? Is there anything you could do? And around that time was when I was writing a book. And I have a whole chapter where I break down the education system in the inner city and how bad it is, and maybe some tools that could probably fix it. And so, yeah, I think, you know, because if you can't qualify from an educational standpoint to even get in the military, you definitely ain't going to qualify from an educational standpoint to get into the teams, right?
For sure. And so, that educational, if they're getting out of there and they don't have the ability to read or function in society, you're setting up generational problems.
Exactly. 100%. But, yeah, I mean, I don't think it's the SEAL team's fault as it relates. Like, some people I've been asked, hey, is the SEAL team's racist? Is that why there's less than 1%? That's why it is, like, One black, and I want to
say. The only way I think you could get there, and this is from my own experience, mm-hmm. to describe it as racist, if you only looked purely at the mathematical stats
yeah.
and didn't have an understanding of the pipeline, because, I mean, I don't know. I mean, you'd be the person to answer this. Did you experience racism when you were in the SEAL teams?
No, I didn't. I think like I've experienced racism in other realms of life, but I can't recall experiencing racism in the SEAL teams. And one of the things that I personally loved about the SEAL teams was the fact that it's, in my opinion, it's very performance based.
Yeah, nobody gives a fuck.
Yeah,
who you are or where you came from.
Yeah.
It's like, hey,
can
man,
you do the job.
You can't meet the standard, so you can now kick rocks
exactly.
down the road.
And that's whether you're in buds, and that's whether you're in a platoon.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what I loved about the teams is that it's, you know, there's a saying, you know this, you know, way more than I do. You know, your reputation follows you. It starts at buds, right? And what I loved about the teams, well, I felt like out of all of the places I've been in life and all the jobs that I've done, that was the one place where it's just like if you do your job, you'll be treated good. If you suck at your job, you're going to know about it because the platoon mates are going to, you know, hammer you and stay on you.
There'll be conversations and
exactly.
duct tape and rigors tape involved.
Yeah, 100%. And so, you know, I say all that to say, you know, I've never experienced racism in the teams. You know what I mean?
I almost think, though, obviously, given what's going on in the world, mm-hmm. it's an interesting time because I don't feel like I saw racism in the teams either.
Yeah.
It was, but it also, to me, I think might be a unicorn of an environment because it was so specifically based on performance.
Yeah, yeah.
And the negatives to not meeting that performance were so dire in their consequences that if you spend long enough there, it actually makes it difficult to understand what the fuck is going on in the rest of the world.
Yeah.
Because that was my optic from being a young man into my late 30s.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I come from that world. I'm like, no, the standard is this. Like, it's tough. It makes it like I don't understand a lot of what I see and what's going on.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, let me just dissect. You said don't understand what, as far as outside of the teams or inside the teams?
Well, the teams, right? If you're like, you spend so much of your time in there in an environment that I would agree is not racially based.
Yeah.
And then you hear people talking about right now in society, it almost seems as if everything is racially
based.
You have this, you're like, but. That's, you know what I mean? That's not my experience.
Yeah,
so it makes it more difficult to understand.
To understand it. Got it.
Or to answer questions about it.
Yeah.
Because my answers when it comes to diversity, I agree with you. And I say the same thing when I'm asked. I think diversity is great. Diversity of thought, diversity of belief.
Yes.
You shouldn't modify standards
for
diversity.
No, 100%. 100%.
And it's...
That's what makes a team a team. That's what makes a team effective is when you have diversity in... Well, a team... I think the more diverse a team can be... the more effective that team could be.
I completely agree.
And as you said, not just in race, but in thought and
belief,
all these beliefs,
yes.
everything, you know? And I think it's not just lacking in a lot of other arenas, like even in Hollywood, you know, like working in Hollywood, you just, when you look at the leadership at the executive level, there's no diversity really. And then when you look at people who are green lighting movies, and now you understand why a lot of the movies are what they are, because you have one specific group and gender and race that are
entrenched.
For the most part, and green lighting certain movies. And so, you know, like I brought this up in a podcast before. It's just like, you know, how many films, African American ensemble films, have you seen in the last 7 years where the budget for that film was over $70-80 million?
Probably Black Panther is the only one you can think of.
One,
yeah.
Right? How many, you know, predominantly white or white ensemble films have you seen where the budget was over $70 million? A whole lot. And so when you, if you just look at it from that perspective, it's just like, it's not just in that, it's in the corporate level, it's all over the place. And I think, you know, a lot of people don't like the term systemic racism. You know, having you know, grown up in the Bronx and having witnessed and experienced, I do believe that there are certain systems in place that need to be rectified, right? That that do affect certain groups from moving forward. Case in point, education. You know, when you look at the education system, like take New York City. When you look at the education system in the Bronx, and then you cross town and you go into certain parts of Manhattan, public school system, night and day, right? And I know a big part of that is taxes, right? So anyway, I just say all that. I can't remember how we got on that. I think that
That creates an unlevel playing field to begin with.
Yes,
you know, I totally agree with it. And again, it's fuck, man, I sit back and I watch what's going on in the world, and I see these people arguing for a light switch solution. And it's not, I'm like, hey, man, like, we're talking some complicated, entrenched, ingrained shit. Education system, that like that reform, I think every system, every single one should be open for judgment, review, and reform. I think that's how we evolve as a society. I mean, look 100%. At the Constitution of the United States. It's designed to be amended. It's supposed to be malleable. And roll with this as a country. Because we're fucking idiots and we're figuring our way out.
No, 100%.
So all these systems should, you have to do that to make them better. And I just see people wanting to see the solution on Instagram or Twitter.
And it's not.
We're talking years. Years.
And we're talking, actually not just posting and not just talking about it, but actually doing something. Like, you know, it frustrates me. I'm trying to be careful how I say certain things, but because people could take one soundbite and twist and put it on Twitter. Oh, you said this. You know what I mean?
An out of context.
Out of context, man. And if that's the crazy, and then you get canceled because you just like, no, dude. Like, but you know, put your money where your mouth is, you know, is what I, and especially as it relates to, you know, celebrities and Hollywood and athletes and all this stuff and all these people who speak out, or maybe people on social media. If you're going to post something, you better be going out and doing something or have been doing something, right? You know, one thing I learned, especially in the teams, is every great, well, specifically in the teams, is every great military leader will never make you do something that they have not done or that they are not willing to do. Right.
And that's why you would follow those people. They're like, fix bayonets. You're like, son of a bitch.
Exactly.
I don't want to do this, but the dude asking me to do this, not that you and I ever did a bayonet charge. Fucking wanted to at least one time. Let me clarify that. In training, a bayonet charge in real life would suck balls. Biggest of balls. But you know that, and that's one thing, you know, it was interesting for me when I shifted from being an enlisted to an officer. That was obviously the largest leadership role that I had, and I was super cognizant of never asking people to do something I wouldn't do myself. Because the second you do that, you can almost see it in the people that work for you. They look at you and they're like, okay, dude. And your credibility. It starts that, it's like one of those sand hourglasses, but you just popped a hole in it and all your sand's starting to come out of that thing.
Credibility's shot. And you know, that's why I see a lot, you know, so many people go to social media. Like, and I'm like, I hope this doesn't come off the wrong way, like me beating my own horn, but you know, I've been for years, especially after I got out of the team, I was just like, you know, I see a problem. You know, like my whole thesis when I was finishing up my master's was on how to combat the murder rate in the South Side of Chicago, you know. And
which people should Google. It's
sad.
Un-fucking believable how
crazy.
High it is.
It's crazy. And you know, after when I was working on my thesis, I was just like, damn, bro, like I'm a SEAL dude. I come from the streets in New York. Like, I need to be using my influence to do more, like, instead of just talk about it. So I started going to prisons, man. Like, I'm like, dude, I'm in prisons. I'm in jails. I'm like, I work with a nonprofit called City Hope, I'm in inner city schools in the hoods. I'm with gang members. I'm using my time and my resources to try and be that change. And to try and bring that healing. Like, I'm talking to police officers. Like, I started giving out my phone number to police officers on Instagram. Like, they would hit me up. Hey, I heard you on this interview. Let's connect. And like, I was like, all right, let's connect. Let's have some conversations. How can I help you? How can we change things, you know? And I think that that's where it should be. If you're going to, I don't want people posting nothing or saying nothing unless you're actually doing something.
Yeah, you know what you're talking about, actually connecting with them, that's the nucleus of actual change.
Yeah.
A post, like,
yeah.
Fuck off.
100%.
If that's all it's going to be, and you're not going to commit yourself or dedicate yourself to trying to make a difference,
exactly.
Then piss, you know, go piss up into the wind.
Yeah.
And for people who don't know, that means it comes back on
you.
It comes. I know that because I've actually done it myself, and it really sucks. You need to turn your back to the wind. But then it creates a vortex, and it still goes on you.
And you smell like urine for the rest of the day.
What was the conclusion you came to with your thesis when it comes to Chicago? Because, and this is an interesting one, right? Because obviously the Black Lives Matter movement is huge right now. And you start seeing people like, where are you at for the 16 people that were killed in Chicago this weekend? And there's a huge disconnect. And the number of people dying, and I have some friends who are law enforcement there. Holy shit,
dude. Man. Like New York City right now, I think the crime rate is like up, what? I mean, please don't quote me on this, but I saw something like around 200%.
I think it's
something like that.
Yeah.
You know, where I'm at with the whole Black Lives Matter thing is, like, it's hard for me to connect in anything to a specific organization. Like, even as in the best example that I use is, like, you know, as a Christian, like, it's hard for me to be so rooted in an institution of Christianity, right? For me, it's like I'm about the essence of it, the meaning, the heart behind it, but not necessarily like dedicated to the organization. I'm for the movement and the essence of Black Lives Matter, because I think I'm not fully read into the organization, so I can't really get behind it. But
I believe, from my understanding, they're a little vague on the organization. They're absent leadership intentionally at a national level, which can create problems as well, because then you get these regional
offshoots. And my thing is, you know, because I think for a long time, in my opinion, it's been as though Black lives, Black stories, Black justice, Black education has not mattered. And that's why I'm kind of like for the essence of it and changing the initiative. But at the same time, you know, as you said, it can't just be about Black Lives Matter when a cop kills a Black person, my opinion. If Black lives matter, Black lives have to matter all the time. If a Black person kills a Black person, like this poor girl, Sequoria Turner.
I know. I couldn't believe it.
You know what I'm saying? In Atlanta.
Was she like
8 years old?
I was going to say, I thought it was six. Yeah, there was another one. I think it was in Chicago. It was like a six-year-old. Or 12 or 13. Yeah. It's like, what's going on?
You know, it's like Nipsey Hussle. Come on. And that's why I'm in the prisons. That's why I'm in the jails. That's why, because Black Lives Matter matters to me. So because, and it has mattered to me. It's not just now because of it's a big thing in the news. It has mattered to me. And so what does that look like? You know, the Bible says faith without works is dead. So for me, what does that look like for me? That means, okay, Black Lives Matter, I'm going to go into the schools. I'm going to go into the prisons. I'm going to go into the jail. I'm going to spend time. I'm going to sit. I'm going to try and create content that helps the Black community get out of the situations that we're in, you know. And so that's what it means to me. It's more about action and change. And my heart breaks, you know, anytime anybody is killed, you know, in an unjust way, my heart breaks, especially when it's a kid, especially when you see what's going on in Chicago. To answer your question about what the conclusion, there was a lot of conclusion, a lot of solutions that I came to as far as how to combat the murder rate, I think. But 2016 is when I wrote this thing. So if my memory, I should have read it before I came on here. Like, it's funny because I thought about maybe you should read your thesis if it comes up. I totally forgot to, man.
Don't worry about that.
But it goes back to that lesson. I didn't learn to be prepared. But it had to, big part of it was education was one solution. It's totally unpacked. A big part of it was community relations with the police and working together with the police, the community working together with the police to try and minimize the crime rate, i.e. if some dude kills another dude or a girl and you know who it is, tell them.
Yeah.
This whole, y'all ain't gonna snitch because this and that. Kill a little girl. You know what I mean? That's something that pisses me off all the time. It's like if we matter to each other, then help fix that situation instead of be like, I ain't gonna snitch.
Or they don't want to talk to the police because they have such a negative view. Yeah.
You know, and like I watch First 48 all the time. You ever see that show First 48 on A&E?
I haven't watched the show, but I know what you're talking about.
It's a crazy show. So what they do is they follow.
It's the murders, right?
It's the murders. They follow real murders, you know, like for the first 48 hours. Because they say if the crime's not solved in the first 48, then it usually goes cold.
Idiots get into these interrogation rooms, and they're like, I didn't do it. And the cop will go, tell me the truth. They're like, fuck, you got me. I did it. I'm like, you suck.
Yeah. No, but it's good. But a lot of the times, you know, you see these sad cases, and I don't want to say anything. I don't want to do anything. But then you do get the anomaly cases of people who are just like, you know what? I love that person. I had real love for that person. I care for that person, their well-being. That's who did it. And I think, you know, a lot of people have turned it into a weakness to say something. And I think it's more of a strength to be bold and stand up and say, you know what? That person's life mattered to me, or All Lives Matter, my people's lives matter to me.
Yeah.
And because of that, I'm going to do something about it.
Well, and nothing you is going to change but with a desire to not snitch. I completely and utterly understand where they're coming from. I'm like, okay, I get that.
And I get a part of it too. Part of it.
But there's no change that comes from that. What is happening or has happened is going to continue to do so into the future.
Yeah. The part of it I do kind of get is, maybe my family get killed.
Maybe, I can understand
I got to go back to that. I got to go back to this environment. Like
we saw a lot of that overseas. That's why that makes sense to me.
So that part of it I get. The other part when your family is not in danger, that's hard for me. Like this whole Sequoia Taylor thing. Like they just upped the reward to $20,000. Why should it have to be $20,000?
Yeah.
For somebody to say something. Like, is that the value of her life, $20,000? Like, somebody should come out and be like, yo, somebody who, because I guarantee you, whoever did it or whoever's about it, there's other people around them that know, yo, you did that, right? Go to that person. Yo, man, you messed up. You messed up. Let's fix this. You know, and I don't know if that person's watching, but listen, man, situations like that, go out, say something, man. Like, it takes more strength to say something, to fix it, to give that family peace, than I'm gonna be a tough guy and this and that. Doesn't get anywhere, you know?
Yeah, it perpetuates the problem.
And, you know, another thing that's crazy to me is, like, you know, while we're on the topic, is, like, a lot of these corporations and stuff going back to action, and like, oh, you know, Black Lives Matter, okay, cool. And in my opinion, I think a lot of them are doing it because they like if they don't do it, they don't post it, then they think nobody's gonna buy my product or whatever. But let's see how much Black Lives Matter to you 2, 3, 4, 5 months from now when we come sit in your executive meeting or your chairman's meeting, you know what I mean? And see how much. I think a lot of people too are just it's just optics, right?
I think there's an essence of that for sure. Yeah. People are. I think a lot of people don't know what to do or what to say, but they feel like they have to do or say something.
Yes.
And they're almost more afraid of being quiet and judged.
Yeah.
It's a shit show.
Yeah, it is.
I see the stuff coming up about Chicago and just the pure numbers and just talking with the people that I know there.
Yeah.
What a travesty, man.
Yeah, man.
An absolute and utter travesty. Yeah. And that's not the only city where that stuff's happening.
No, New York, man. New York. My mom's is in the Bronx. my mother's still in the Bronx, and my aunt, I got an aunt who's 100, about to be 102. She's in like the Washington Heights area. You know what I mean? Like, and so I don't know, I struggle with a lot of it. But I think the cool thing, is that, I've had a diverse life, so I'm able to see things from, diverse perspectives, being rich, being poor, being living in Africa, living in America, growing up hating the cops, being somewhat of a cop as a SEAL, I've been able to live in these. So I think, if more people with diverse backgrounds speak up and not just speak up, but show the fruits of their heart, show the fruits protesting is cool. Yeah, I'm not knocking that, but let's go a step further.
Yeah, protest is the opening to the conversation. Yeah. There's got to be additional steps.
Yeah, let's go a step further
beyond that, in my opinion.
Let's go to some schools. Let's go to some political leaders and have some real tough conversations. Let's go into politics. Let's put our money where our mouth.
Crazy. Right. I don't have to go into fucking politics.
Yeah. No, I don't know about that.
Anybody who goes into politics is out of their mind. To include Dan Crenshaw.
Yeah, Dan Crenshaw. he was
out of his mind.
Yeah, he was Charlie Patil. We were the same task unit. Yeah.
It's 1 degree of separation of the SEAL team. It's unbelievable.
Yeah. Man.
What are your experiences like when you go into the prisons? I have absolutely no experience doing anything like that.
It's awesome, man. It's like, dude. It's like, well, I'm not gonna front. First time I started, it was scary.
Yeah,
because
if you hadn't said that, I'd be like, Remi, you're lying,
bitch. I'm being real. I don't care. Ain't no shame in my game.
Here's the thing. There's some tough dudes that we worked with.
Yeah.
If you go into a prison and you are not scared, you need to get your head checked.
No, for real. here's one story. I go into this prison, and this is like a max. I can't even remember what level prison it was, but it was one of them high level prisons. Murderers.
So you're saying that the people in there were not in there for jaywalking?
No, not at all. This is like,
This is
there was a serial killer in one prison. I think this prison I went to, but I'm in this prison. We walk through it. You got to go through all these bars, and as a SEAL, I'm thinking, man, like if I ever get trapped in here, how would I escape? I'm like, I gotta figure out a way. But we go into this gymnasium area, this big gymnasium area, and one end of the gymnasium is connected to the main building, and the other end of the gymnasium is connected to the yard, this massive yard where they all walk around. And in that gymnasium area is like this glass box. And it's like, it was...
That sounds like some Hannibal Lecter shit right there.
But no, the security, that's for the security guard.
Okay.
And so guard comes up to me. He's like, all right, everybody's, bell's going to ring. Everybody's going to come here. I'm like, where you going to be? He's like, I'm going to be in the box. I was like, in the box?
Is there room in the box for me?
Yeah, in the box. And he has a podium set up. They got the chairs lined up. He's like, hey, they're not supposed to do this. They're not supposed to approach you. They're supposed to stay safe. I'm like, all right, cool. So I go to the podium. Doors open. All of them come in. I'm like, yo, I'm not going to be. I'm not Superman.
Yeah.
It's no, I don't care, Navy SEAL. Like,
doesn't
it don't
mean
matter.
Shit.
You're not going to fight 100 dudes. Yep. Like, it's not happening. Brolic, and they're big dudes. And I was like, if somebody wants to start a riot, is going down. I'm not going to, like, there's no winning. I'm not going to win. But it was cool. They were mad respectful. And a lot of them were just like, yo, man, you a SEAL? We heard you a SEAL. I'm like, yeah. And they're like, yo, mad respect. Like, you are, like, it, to them, they were like, you one of us. Because they were like biker gang dudes in there, murderers. And so they had these, they're hard dudes, so to speak. So they felt like they could identify, and it became cool. And at the end, like, we're shaking hands and they coming close. And I think if you give off that sheepish, that essence, they smell that. But if you stand right and you confident, not like prideful, but confident,
they smell that too.
They smell that and they respect you. And, you know, and that's how I was. That's what I learned. Just be confident, you know? And I remember towards the end of the talk, they all surrounded me. And they were like, man, we just want to say we appreciate you coming in. People don't come in and talk to us.
What did you talk to them about?
I talked to them about transformation. I talked to them about, you know, your life is not over, though you're in this place. I talked to them about second chances. I talked to them about life. I tried to motivate them. You know what I mean? I talked to them about education, you know? So it was, I shared my story, but interweaving in those points.
Yeah.
You know, transformation, it's not over. You know, motivate yourself. The main thing, especially as it relates to my story, when I go do these talks, is transformation. Like, I was at Rikers Island Jail last year. And man, that was hard, man, because a lot of the kids, there's kids in there, man. Like, to me, I'm 37, so it's like 18, 19, 20, they're kids to me.
Isn't it crazy what an 18-year-old looks like now, being older?
Yeah, tall, lanky. Yeah, man, like, it was sad because I remember one kid, I spoke at the graduation ceremony because there was a graduation ceremony for the inmates who decided to pursue their GED while locked up or pursue their high school diploma. And the families and everything went in, his kids and then this one kid came up to me, he's like, I'm getting shipped to prison tomorrow. And the prison that was came to pick him up, they weren't gonna let him in the graduation. Because they were just like, yo, dude, like, it's time to go. And his mom was crying and everything. And same thing, I talked to them, transformation. I told his kids, man, like, keep going with your education. I know some of you are going to prison. Don't stop. Like, same thing my recruiter said. You know, though people make mistakes, that doesn't mean that they don't have potential. I try to talk to them about not getting clicked up in these gangs. Like, being like my brother was, you know. And that's all I could do. All I could do is use my story. And again, they could relate to me. And I feel like a lot of them listen to me because I come from the same environment they came from, you know? And I hope that I give them hope that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Some of these kids are not going to ever get out of prison.
Yeah.
It's double murders.
Yeah, the math just isn't in their favor. They're not going to get out.
Yeah. But some are. And so I'm not just speaking to those who are. I am trying to speak to those who are not, you know.
The message, it still could change their life.
Yeah.
You know, what they're able to do or influence outside of their individual self may be smaller, but it still could change their life for the better.
100%. So I say all that to say, man, I encourage as many people who have that platform, like, you know, SEALs, man, like celebrities, athletes, like people in those positions respect to go into those places. It means so much to them. It makes them feel human. I've had guys come up to me and say, I feel human. I've been to women's prison is, that's on a whole nother level.
Really?
Oh, dude, I went to a maximum security women's prison. It's crazy, man. There was way more security. They had guards. It was like 300 women in there. They had guards, like a square guards around them, and more, because the women's prison out here are worse.
Like violence wise?
Yeah, man. Yeah. that's what they told me at the prison. They was like, because I remember that same day I went to the men's prison, and then the organization I was with said, okay, now we're going to go to the women's prison, but it's worse. It's like, they know how to play nice, and they seem nice.
Then they'll
don't
cut
get
you.
Don't get it twisted.
Then they'll cut
don't
you.
Don't get it twisted. You know. And they haven't seen a guy in a long time. Well, you know, outside, so you get the remarks and the whistling and all that kind of stuff. But but you know,
you were getting cat calls.
Yeah, oh yeah, you do. I mean, they're in prison. Like some of them for life. I remember this one. But it's you get touching stories and you know, like this one lady came up to me. She said, "Thank you so much for coming. I'm in here for murder. I'm probably never going to get out." She was like, but you coming here made my day. And she had a kid. She's like, my son is 4 or 5. And, you know, I just hope to be able to share your story with my son, you know, so that his life can change. You know, and at the end of the day, that's what life is about for me. You know, it's using my platform, my experience, my stories, the diversity of my life to give hope, to inspire people, to change narratives, and, you know, to make a difference. And that's why I love being in the prisons, the jails, and in the streets and at times.
You got a lot of time left, too. I mean, you're young. Yeah. I'll be dead of old age, like, probably tomorrow. But you got time.
Nah, man, dude. You, what, 3 years older than me?
I'm 42.
Yeah, you're 4 years. I'll be 38 next month.
Run the math. I'm almost 43. You'll be 38.
I'll be
still 5.
Yeah, 5, yeah.
What month are you born?
August 10th.
All right. I'm October 10th.
Oh, well, right behind you.
10-10, easier to remember than 8-10.
Yeah, 8-10, yeah.
You got a lot of time left, and your message is awesome. What are you going to do? You're into some, in addition to that, obviously, you still have ties into Hollywood.
Yeah, yeah.
How does Remy spend his average week? I mean, what's firing you up now?
Writing, man. Writing, storytelling, as I shared earlier, it was film that inspired me to go into the teams. And so just being able to move through that medium and shape stories, not just for the purpose of entertainment, but for education, inspiration, and motivation. So, you know, writing, you know, that's my daily schedule. I'm writing films and TV shows. We were talking off the air before we got on. I just got hired 2 weeks ago, just signed a contract 2 weeks ago to adapt a book into a TV series for a streamer.
And did you teach yourself how to do that? I mean, or did you, in your education, did you...
Yes and no. I mean, one, as I shared earlier, my mother would, like, you get the parents, the football dads, who are like, you're going to play football, go out there in the yard, throw some more quarterbacks, throw some more balls. My mom was like that with writing. You will be a fantastic writer. You will write. And so, like, writing had always been in my DNA from an early age. And then fast forward to the teens, we talked about the human stuff I did. A big part of it was writing. Like, you have those meetings. You collect that intelligence. You can't just pick up the phone and say, "Hey, this is what you got to. You got to write detailed reports." And
it's funny they never make that into the movie. It's weird.
Yeah, I know, right? And the funny thing is, so many, and it doesn't make. I think it was scared dudes away, like, oh, no, because in the so many team guys don't want to go into that field because they're like, last thing I want to do after an op or before op is write something, right?
I have been in fistfights over PowerPoint.
Yeah,
and I tell people like, no, you haven't. I'm like, you don't understand.
Yeah.
The bullets snapping by your head and shit blowing up.
Yeah.
That's about 0.01% of your life.
Yep, yep.
You're sending emails, PowerPoint briefs. I had a mission come back one time on that 2010 deployment. They would not even send it to the commanding general for approval.
Yeah.
Because on the insert portion, or it was infill, we were in the helicopters getting ready to go to the insert. The helicopters were oriented in the wrong direction.
Yikes.
They weren't facing the direction of flight.
And they pulled the whole op because of that?
They didn't pull it. They wouldn't even submit it for mission approval until I went into fucking PowerPoint and flipped the helicopters.
That's ridiculous.
Like, you sons of bitches. Where is that in the movies?
Yeah. It's not going to happen, man. No. It's like cut two.
Yeah, people cut are like, boring.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, after the writing in the teams and, you know, I got my book deal. The way I got my book deal was through Kathy Lee Gifford. You know, I'm close to the Gifford family. As a matter of fact, her son Cody is my writing partner on this current TV show I'm doing. And she pretty much walked me to the publisher and said, "Man, you got this guy's got an amazing story. You need to sign to a book deal." And when I was doing the contract, we were talking about writers, like, who do you want to get to write your book? Because it's like the concept is like, you can't write your book. Like, so who are you going to get to write your book?
I mean, is the normal template, you have an interesting, this is probably what they want to overlay onto you. Mm-hmm. You have an interesting story, mm-hmm. so let me find a writer to write your story for you instead of you writing it.
It's either who do you want to write your story or let us help you find a writer to write your story, right? Because it's like no confidence.
Yeah.
And that kind of, it influenced me a bit. To the point where I lost confidence. I was just like, I can't write my book. So I was like, oh, well, my mom's been a writer for, let me have my mom write the book. And so they was like, okay, so that's part of how the contract got approved. Like, it's like, okay, your mom's gonna be the writer. And my mom, she wrote two chapters that are now gonna be in her book, because I'm co-writing her book now. So this is
how the tides have turned.
And it was great, but as I was reading, I was just like, this is not my story. It's her story, and it's not the way I would tell a story. And so I told my mom, I said, Mom, I'm going to do this. And she was like, okay. And so I started from the beginning, and I got halfway through the book. And the blessing in it, too, at the same time, I was at the Lee Strasberg Institute studying film and theater. And while I was there, I was learning a lot about story arc and character arc, and I was learning about scene study and method acting and improv and just all of these elements
cohesive ways to
telling
to tell
stories. And I was learning about it from the perspective of the actor more so than the perspective of the writer. So it was almost like reverse engineering it. You have the actor, he does lines, but then how do we get, where does that come from? It comes from writing a script. And then I had to dissect these scripts, and I'm learning so much, and so I'm implementing all of these things that I'm learning into my writing while at the same time writing the book.
Oh, what a fascinating story.
It was crazy, man. It was crazy. And I tell people all the time, you know, you never know how what you're doing now is indirectly preparing you for what you will be doing later. You know, don't despise small beginnings. And so I get halfway through the book in December of 2017, and my publisher, I turn in my book. And this, I'm getting to how I got into writing. So people was like, man, this dude's going to, and let me know if I'm giving much information, bro. I turned into my publisher. My publisher was like, this is great writing, but you're over. I'm like, I'm over. And he's like, yeah, you signed, the contract you signed is for 60 to 80,000 words. And I was like, it's like, best analogy I can give is, it's like handing a Mark 46 to some average person on the street. They're gonna be like, what's this? How do I, like, where do I go with this? And I was like, what does that mean? That's like, that means that your book is what you're at 60 to 80,000 words. So I was like, there's no way I could tell my story in 60 to 80,000 words. So I literally got into an argument, disagreement with my publisher. And finally they bent and they said, all right, we'll compromise for you. If you hire a ghostwriter to write the last half of your book, we'll allow you to turn in 130,000 word book, which is the average for a lot of memoirs, especially memoirs, military memoirs, 130 or more.
Okay.
You know? And so I hired a ghostwriter for the last half of the book. And a month later, I call this dude up and I'm like, hey, dude, can I see chapter 15, whatever chapter 15 was at the time? And he was just like, yeah, sure. And he's like, how do you want to do it? Do you want to go over it over the phone? Do you want me to send it to you? You read it and then you call me with your thoughts. I was like, no, let's go over it together on the phone. So he sends me chapter 15. I read the first line. I'm like, nope. I read the second line. I'm like, nope. I read the third line. I'm like, hell no. I read the fourth line. I'm like, yo, bro, did you read the first half of the book? Like, what is this? And here's this like old white dude from Rhode Island trying to write like. So there I was on the block, and this boy over there came up to me and said, where's my 40? And I'm like, yo, where did you even, like, what? And I was like, I had to ask him. It was written so poorly that I was just like, dude, did you even read the first half of the book? And he was like, no. I said, dude, how can you tell the first half, the last half of the story? You don't even know the first half. He's like, I didn't want to be influenced by your voice. I said, that's the purpose. You have to get influenced by my voice so it reads about like one fluid book. And he was just like, oh, yeah, but at least I told you the truth. I was like, dude, we need to fix this right freaking now because my deadline to turn in the book is in 2 months, man. And he's like, oh, I can't right now. I'm on the East Coast. I said, well, we're going to do it tonight. He's like, I'm going to a party tonight. I said, well, we're going to do it after you get back from the parties. I'm going to be drinking. I was like, yo, bro, I was hot. I was like, we need to fix this
You're
now.
You're fired.
So I said, you know what? Screw it. I said, I'm going to work on this tonight. We get on the phone tomorrow. We'll go over what I wrote for this chat. I don't even want to read the next 2 chapters. So he's like, I bet. And I said, your job is to read the rest of the book, the first half of the book, by tomorrow morning. Got it? He's like, yeah, I got it. First thing he does when he calls me up the next day, he's like, yo, dude, he said, did you read the first half? Did you write the first half of that book? I was like, yeah, I wrote the first half of the book. He's like, you sure you didn't have dictated to somebody and then they took it and wrote it for you? I was like, no, bro, I wrote it. I'm a writer, man. My mom's had me writing since I was a kid. He's like, yo, this is good writing. He was like, And you rewrote that chapter that I sent you? I was like, yes. He's like, wow. He's like, I'm gonna be honest with you. I've never lost a job in my 30 years of being a writer. He said, you need to write this book. Like, you need to write this book.
Why did that thing turn off, Remy?
Memory?
I don't know. Hold on.
Yeah, so
primary, secondary SD cards, dude. Yeah. I'm fucking ready.
There you go, man. One is none, two is one, right?
Yeah. And so, then three is better.
Yeah, yeah. So he you know, he was just amazed by the writing, and he was like, hey, I've never lost a job in 30 years, but I'm going to tell you, dude, you need, your publisher was wrong. Like, you need to keep writing this book. Like, no one can tell this story like you can. And I wrote the rest of the book, and I turned it into my publisher, the president, the vice president of the company, and she read it, like, that weekend. Like, I turned it in ahead of time. And she called me. She sent me an email. I still have it to this day. And she said, listen, dude, I know we've had a lot of battles back and forth. I didn't think you could pull it off, but this book is amazing. She's like, you're a really gifted writer. And I'm so glad that you didn't stick with the ghostwriter and you pushed through and wrote it yourself. And after I wrote that book, that's when I was just like, I want to tell more stories and I want to try my hand in a different realm, which is writing film and TV shows.
You think you'll ever get into the behind the camera type stuff?
That's my long-term goal. I'd love to be a director.
Okay.
So long-term goal, I'd love to be a writer-director. I just know that there's a process to that. And the way I write, interestingly, like a lot of the feedback that I get from my book and also from the screenplays that I write is, dude, you're very visual. Like the way you write is visual. Like I feel like I could see it. It's like you're directing it as you're writing it, you know?
So it'll play nicely when you want to transition to that
exactly,
level as well.
Exactly. And I think that comes from being on sets and consulting and seeing, you know, Michael Bay work and Peter Berg and you know, I was just working on a TV show with Apple and working with Jakob, who's an amazing director, seeing how they work. And then I'm on set and I'm not just seeing it from the perspective of a writer and never having been on set. I'm seeing it from the perspective of being on set and being a writer and visually how the story is told, not just literary, but with the camera movements and all that kind of stuff as well.
It's a complex world. I've done limited technical advising, but damn.
Yeah.
It's not just show up and like, all right, you know, act monkey, dance for me. There's a lot of shit that goes into it. Yeah. The DPs.
I ain't got coronavirus. I promise.
Yeah, but dude, the photography, the sets, the wardrobe. Holy
props.
Shit! And the amount of time. So I worked behind the scenes on the History Channel show 6.
Oh yeah.
And they would do 7 to 10 days of prep for a 7-day shoot.
Yeah.
And you're not like taking it easy on those 7 to 10 days.
Yeah.
It was pretty nuts.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's, I got a Peter Berg story for you if you're ready.
Yeah. All
right. So.
I love Pete, man.
He probably doesn't remember me, but he might when I tell you this story because there was pain involved for him. He came to Bud's and he wanted to run the O course. And I'm just not starstruck. I don't give two shits.
So
I was just spent my time making fun of him. And I was there and he invited me up to a birthday party at his house. And they wanted to go play paintball.
Oh, yikes.
So we roll to play paintball and like Marcus Luttrell is there.
Yeah.
Marcus is on Pete's team. And I forget where we were, but it ended up. They ended up getting pinned in this little low ground area, and I can just see two little heads sticking out there, and Marcus. And so I immediately like bust off to the right. I'm like, I'm just going to just ambush 101 from the side.
Yeah.
And I hear Marcus stick his head up. He's like, oh, it's Andy. We're fucked.
Yeah.
And then Pete just stands up, and I just start stitching him. And then we go to the next. So they get annihilated because they were stuck. We go to the next one.
Was there any other team guys with you on your team? Or you were the only team?
I think Harry Humphries was on my team.
Oh, yeah.
So I don't know if he was a team guy or not.
Nah,
I
mean, he's old, man.
He's old as shit. We go to another one, and I forget what it was. It was like, they're going to come at us. It was like, it was me and Marcus. They're like, well, we'll just send everybody against you guys. I'm like, okay, we can play this game.
Yeah.
And I remember just standing, I was on the corner of a building, and I see Pete trying to use concealment, which he's not. And I take one shot, and it hits him directly in the side of the head from a good distance. And he starts shooting back at me. I'm like, hey, dude, by the rules, you're dead, but whatever. Yeah. And I just stood still. I didn't even move because they were just whipping all over the place.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he was just like dumbfounded. He's like, why didn't you move? I'm like, because you can't shoot for shit.
Yeah.
And I shot another round and hit him directly in the head. And he's just like, fuck you guys. That's my Peter Burke story.
That is funny, dude. That is so funny. Yeah, man. Oh, man, that's funny.
It's a weird world up there. Those guys live in La La Land for sure.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
But the influence that you can have, man, like coming out of that world. Yeah, man, and the reach, man. It's like, and I'm grateful for the consulting side of the industry because it really, I was able to get behind the scenes and see the producers and how they work and the writers and how much power they have to shift culture, you know, in it. And I was just like, I don't want to do this consulting thing anymore. I was like, I want to write films and I want to be on the producing side. And so I bought Final Draft, which is a system to write that you could write help format screenplays. And I just started like taking classes, man, like not formal classes, but like the master class, Aaron Sorkin, how he writes, you know, three act structure, All This Lost Moments, Michael Haig, just studying all his
videos.
Isn't
it crazy the amount of information that is just at your fingertips?
Yeah, YouTube, you could get your PhD times three by sitting and watching
all
YouTube
this
video.
YouTube,
right?
What equipment do you need for a podcast?
Yeah.
What electronics?
Exactly.
What editing software?
Exactly.
It's 100% YouTube, man.
Yep, exactly.
It's amazing.
Yeah, it's amazing, man. And I just started learning, and then I wrote my first film, which is now my agent is going to be taking wide this week. Can't go into all the details because it's a high concept, unique action thriller type deal. And that script is I sent it out to a few people to get feedback before I took it to somebody who had like some power to do something. And all the feedback was like, dude, you wrote this. Wow, this is great for a first script. And then I submitted to a big management company, which I'm not with anymore. And they signed me off for it. They were just like, hey, dude, you know how to write films. And they signed me off of it.
That's so awesome, man.
Yeah. And then we did some rewrites. And then things kind of fell apart just on the business side, relationship things, relationship from relationship perspective. And then I got signed to another agency off of that script and another script I wrote about the first group of African Americans to serve in special operations. And a true story, amazing story. It's a story I came across and I was just like, dude, I never heard this before.
I saw you posted on that on Instagram.
Yeah.
I think the two guys that were in that picture were the original, like UDT?
No, that's a different project.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, that's a story I just came across.
I didn't know that history either.
Those
stories to me though are fascinating.
Crazy,
man.
Dude. Like I was just like, how come I never knew this? And so my goal with that is I have somebody who has a journal from one of those two first black UDT dudes. And so she's supposed to give me the journal, but my goal is to, like, I'd love to adapt that into a limited series.
That'd be so cool,
or,
man.
Or a film. I'm thinking leaning more towards film because visually I already kind of see how it will play out. But yeah, the script, the other film is like where that UDT story is two, this is about a unit. And this, I can't go on all the details because it's such a fascinating story. Somebody be like, oh, Steph.
Yep.
And plus, a big production company. I can't name them, but a massive production company that's led by a very famous actor just picked up that script.
That's awesome,
right?
Man.
So I wrote that film, and it was between that film and the community that got me signed to an agency, and I was there for a while, and then I moved to the agency I'm with now, and those scripts got me signed there, and I'm with APA, and then they negotiated this deal for this slave stealer story, which is a TV show I just got hired on 2 weeks ago, and it's an amazing. To answer your question in short, that's what I'm doing. I'm sitting on my computer, I'm writing stories, I'm crafting stories, I'm trying to figure out the best way in the stories, and I'm trying to find amazing stories that haven't been told to tell. And this slave stealer story is one of them. It follows Harriet Jacobs, and she was a slave in the 1800s, early 1800s. And this woman, bro, she, like, when I read the book, I was like SEAL training. Like, dang, SEAL. Like, I broke my ankle SEAL training. Freaking, like, the mom almost died in hell. Like, I just kept on coming back to me. Like, the stuff that this woman went through to escape slavery was, like, crazy. Like, she hid in a box for 7 years in Eatington, North Carolina, blocks away from her slave master, and she's writing letters from this box, sending the letters to New York and then getting them rerouted back to her slave master blocks away so that he would spend money to send bounty hunters north to look for her, deplete his funds, so much so that he has to sell her kids to their father and essentially get their freedom. I mean,
that's some high level shit.
Yeah, dude, the stuff this woman did, even the little espionage trade, she didn't even know she was doing trade
high level field craft shit. Yeah.
Yeah, she's doing this stuff and she's a slave, dude. I read the story. I was just like, and the producers, they were considering doing it as a film because they have another film that they produced that Fox is distributing. I think Netflix is distributing domestically. Fox is doing it, international distribution on it. And they were considering, it was like, hey, we already have this financing for the slave stealers adaptation. Let's potentially do it as a film. And I read the book. I was just like, I think we should do this as a TV show. And I think that, you know, we could potentially do an anthology type series where we could take some of these stories and just keep building on it and tell other, and there's so many other amazing stories we came across, some that I wish I could mention right now, but I know people be like, oh, I never heard about that. Let me do the research and take that turn. But we've come across some amazing stories that we want to tell in the follow-on seasons. But yeah, man, that's what I'm working on now, man, just trying to tell these stories, man.
It's awesome to see the trajectory and what you're doing. What's the best way for people to find you and support you?
Best way is social media, you know, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn. I got a unique name.
Fucking
so it's
LinkedIn. It's, yeah. Still not sure what that damn
thing. I know. It's like an upscale Facebook, in my opinion.
Yeah.
So you can find me on any one of those social media platforms. Remi Adeleke. I also just jumped on the advisory board for the C4 Foundation. So you can find me on their website, just so, you know, anybody interested in supporting that foundation, that amazing foundation that was made to honor Charlie Keating, which, you know, you put him through BUDS.
Yeah. And for people who want to know more about that, I went in depth on that with Nick Norris, parts 1 and 2, I think we touched on it, but the previous episode.
Yeah. Yeah. And doing amazing things for the community. I've been talking with the other leadership, and we're considering doing some other stuff that I can't go into detail right now, but that's going to be cool for
good shit on the horizon.
Inner city communities, you know, something we talked about, you know. So yeah, C4 Foundation, you can find me on that website and go support it if you can. 4 for 4 campaign. That's been a huge campaign for the foundation, but yeah. And yeah, that's where people could, and City Hope Now, that's another place people could find me. That's another nonprofit I work with inner city kids and to help, you know, educate, inform, and, you know, and be in the lives of inner city kids, people in prison and jails, and support them the best I can with my platform. Do something, not just talk about it, but do something about all that's going on in our country.
You're doing it, man, for sure. You're setting a fucking hell of an example.
Trying, brother.
Yeah, it's trying. Impressive. I'm glad I can call you friend.
Thank you, man. Same here.
Point people in your direction.
Glad I could call you not just friend, but you know, my frog man pops.
There you go.
Even though you failed me in pool comp.
Hey, if you would have met the standard, you would have passed.
I just messing with you, guys.
Thanks for the time, man.
Nah, thank you, brother.